Hi, this is Marlene with Miami Ghost Chronicles, and I want to welcome you to another episode of Stories of the Supernatural. Wherever you find us, whether it's a video on YouTube or on your favorite podcast platform, please like and subscribe to us so that you can get notification of when a new show is released. You can also find us on major social media platforms where I give you a heads up about upcoming shows and which date and time they will be aired. If you go to MiamiGhostChronicles.com, you can find links to the shows, MP3 files which you can download, or links to your favorite platform like iTunes, Spreaker, SoundCloud, and all other major sources. You can find information for upcoming and past talk show appearances as well as new book projects at MarlenePardo.com. You can also purchase books and merchandise there. And you can visit my author page on Amazon at Marlene Pardo Pellicer. Due to popular demand, I'm narrating my true believer stories that I've collected throughout the years in a new series called Supernatural Storytime. You can find links at supernaturalstorytime.com. If you are into classic horror, ghosts, and adventure stories, I narrate some of those at Nightshade Diary, and you can find links at nightshadediary.com. If you would like to read noteworthy news about the paranormal world, true crime, conspiracy stories, and anything that is just plain weird, you can visit the Stranger Than Fiction Stories tab at MiamiGhostChronicles.com. I do want to thank you all for being part of my audience, and I think you are all wonderful. Hi, everybody. This is Marley with Miami Ghost Chronicles, Stories of the Supernatural. How is everybody doing? I'm doing good. And you're going to be super excited when you find out who my guest is. But then again, I'm going to stop because I always get my emails for people saying, how's the farm doing? How are the chickens doing? How are the dogs? How are the birds? How are the... Everybody's doing fine. You know, I'm here in South Florida. Nice, hot, rainy. You know, we got a... This is, of course, hurricane season here for South... Well, you know, for Florida especially. And, you know, what we get is, if not the actual hurricanes, we get depressions, which we got a couple of them off the coast. No danger. As a matter of fact, it looks like they might be heading up into the, like the Outer Banks, maybe the Carolinas, and hopefully they won't develop. But as far as I'm concerned, what we get is a lot of rain, which is good. But normally rainy season here, like in the subtropics, you'll get maybe 45 minutes of rain, an hour, 30 minutes, and then it stops and it dries up. And so basically it's good, but you don't get, you know, inundated. Lately we've been getting a lot of rain, too much rain. So, but it's good. And you know, and of course, me being the nouveau farmer, micro farmer, it's like, oh, it's raining, great. But, and I was saying in my last show now that one of the things that you don't think about till you're actually there is that it's great for your trees, but it's great for everything like the weeds and the grass and that. And so my lawnmower, every time I go out there, I can't even mow the lawn. I got a riding mower. I can't go out there because I get rained out, literally. So, you know, as far as that's concerned, I, you know, but yeah, it's coming along. It's coming along, you know, and my chickens and everybody's fine. And, you know, one of these, my three puppies, one of these days, I'm going to bring one of my chicks in here and show them to you guys for those people that actually see it versus the podcast. But anyway, let's get to the good part. And this is the good part. The good part is the guest that I have here today. Now, this guest, I was lucky enough to appear on his show, on his podcast show, which is called Chasing the Truth. This gentleman's name is Shawn Graham. And let me tell you a little bit about Shawn in case you haven't heard about him. He is the host of the Chasing the Truth with Shawn Graham podcast. And on it, he deals with the paranormal and all things unexplained. The show launched in May of 2018, and it has created most definitely a buzz through the paranormal community. And he's both an expert and a seeker of answers to many of the paranormal community's most asked questions. And you know that I always talk about being an expert in this field. You can, up to a certain point, but definitely there's always, especially in the paranormal, there's just something that has to be left out because there's always new stuff that's coming up that's being discovered. But anyway, now prior to the launch of Chasing the Truth, he spent more than 15 years in the medical field, and during his tenure in the healthcare sector, he suffered a leg amputation stemming from a very serious flesh-eating infection, and he was on life support. Now, during this time on life support, he had a near-death experience, an NDE, and you know, we've spoken about this before on other shows, which personally, to me, in my opinion, NDEs are one of the most compelling proof of survival of our souls, our spirit, whatever you want to call it, after the death of our bodies. But we'll get to that. Now, while he was in a coma, he had encounters with God, souls, angels, demons, and other entities. Later on, he recovered completely. And of course, he now has a heightened sense of the world, full knowledge of God's existence and bond with all of God's creation. Following, of course, the NDE, he's been searching for fellow travelers that have experienced paranormal events. And he is a native of Southwest Virginia. And he's experienced a lot of paranormal encounters throughout his life, you know, of course, prior to having that near-death experience. And he brings that information, that background, and as far as the flavor of his shows, which is an eclectic mix of the paranormal sprinkled with personal anecdotes and jokes. And I want to have you all welcome Shawn to the show. How are you doing today, Shawn?
Oh, I'm doing fantastic. Thanks for having me on, Marlene.
No, absolutely. It is my pleasure. Absolutely my pleasure. And, you know, I tell everybody, because my audience knows I usually, this is not, you know, I don't have any questions here. This is a conversation, but we've conversed before. And I usually ask my guests, well, how did you get into the paranormal? But we already have the answer to that. So before we get into stories, because I know you have a gazillion, God, such compelling stories. You mentioned something briefly, even though it's not about ghosts, but something about a Bigfoot sighting very close to where you live over on the Kentucky side, right?
Yeah, I think it's Whitesburg, Kentucky. It's about 40 miles from me. Mm-hmm. And I don't personally know this guy. Never met him in my life. And I, for whatever reason, what stuck with me was the location and his first name, Shawn.
Oh, okay.
But I don't know if you've heard of TikTok, but
yes.
He has a TikTok account, mm-hmm. and he's been posting, a splattering of Bigfoot sightings, okay. along with, you know, new family stuff and all that other stuff. And then he had a couple of videos where he'd go out of his backyard, and apparently his backyard, which, you know, is similar to the terrain I've got,
right.
is connected to a bigger hill or a mountain, mm-hmm. and he's pointing this camera up the hill, and you hear these vocalizations of which either it's a really big man that's, you know,
right.
been shot to death or something like that. But I'm like, you know, if I know the terrain that's in Whitesburg, I was right. like, there's nothing up there but maybe a coal mine remnants or strip job or whatever up through there.
Right.
And you hear these echoes. And for whatever reason, I can't remember the TikTok's name for whatever, the actual thing. But
okay.
that was my first one of the year that I've heard that's close to me. Okay. Prior to that, I usually hear about one or two good ones. The last one I heard was actually on the other side of Kentucky about a year before. Excuse me. Year before. Was in Jenkins, Kentucky.
Okay.
That was spotted outside of Jenkins, Kentucky, near a well-traveled road. Was a actual visual sighting, but now that was just from hearsay, from I think either a Facebook post or something like that, or a radio, or whatever. And I'm like, wow. And I've heard of Bigfoot in the area, okay. real close to me over the years that I've been here.
Right.
And it's just one of those things. And we've, you know, right before the show, you and I were talking about
right.
some stuff. And I've got
right.
I've
and
got
that, and I was going to mention, you've lived in this area for a long period of time. Your family has, in other words, right?
Yeah. I used to live here up until about 3 years ago before I had to retire. I lived in Tennessee for about 15 years, Northeast
okay.
Tennessee. So it's about the same geographic area, except, mm-hmm. you know, border sites. But this has been my home for a while. Yeah.
Okay.
So, just moving back in.
Well, no. What I'm saying is that sometimes when you know the history of a place, you know your family, you're more familiar, like with either the folklore in some cases, or stories that have been told, or what's normal. Even when you live in an area, you kind of after a while you know what the animals in that area sound like.
Yeah. There was one thing that I got introduced to way back when I was in my mid-teens was the cry of a bobcat.
I've heard that.
And I was telling my dad about it one day, and I said, I heard a baby crying up in this holler. And my dad was like, where'd you hear this at? I was like, right up there. And we're at in the front yard. Yeah, I was pointing up into this little valley. And he said, that was probably a bobcat. And I said, that sounded exactly like a baby crying. I said, I know there's nothing up there other than maybe a logging road or something like that.
Yeah.
But yeah, there's all kinds of strange stuff that goes on in the woods that you never really think about. I've got all kinds of little stories I found in the woods, and my dad's told me about, and even a friend of mine that was in the National Guard. I didn't tell you about this one, but he told me about a unknown, unmapped base that's close by here.
Really?
Yeah, it's on the federal land. I'm butt up against Jefferson National Forest. Actually, my mom's house, their property line. Where her fence line is, mm-hmm. on the other side is Jefferson National Forest line. She could literally walk out of her garage and be on National Forest land within a matter of steps. And isn't the actual base that I personally seen? I was working at a hospital, and this gentleman I was working with was a night shift RN, and he was telling me we're passing them back and forth UFO stories.
Okay.
And I was just telling him what I had seen one night on National Forest land. He said, yeah, I believe that. He said, I'm going to tell you something that you won't believe. And I was like, okay. And he told me where this place was. And he said, you know where this area is? And I said, yeah, I used to try to date this gal that lived right down below from where you were telling me this was. And he was telling me about he got an order. He was part of the motor pool. He was over the motor pool for the region in Lee County, Virginia. And anything in the region, he would, usually he didn't get any calls or anything unless there's broken down equipment. Or during the winter months when the ABC agencies would be stuck up in the mountains and couldn't get out because of snow, he would get the orders to go get this. And he got this faxed order and gave him coordinates to go to. And he actually picked up the phone and called his boss and said, I know where the coordinates are. There's nothing out there. And he got ordered to go pick up this flatbed truck, I think, that had broken down. And he took along a sergeant with him. I think it was a sergeant. Well, it took another fellow that was underneath him in this tow truck, this big, huge tow truck. And he said, well, they got out to where this place was. And I actually went down this road months later and went out to the coordinates. And he almost got there, and his buddy that was in with him said, hey, there's nothing out here but Forestry Road. That's it. Logging
right.
You say, well, we've got to go to exact coordinates. And then if there's nothing there, we'll just say we went to the coordinates. There's nothing but trees and go back. Right. But he said he almost got to the coordinates, and there the break in the tree line, and then a clear field. And then he sees these guarded shack with a big, huge guarded fence with catena wire and all this other stuff. And I was like, buddy, I've been all over these mountains through here. There ain't nothing like that out there. And he said, yeah, try to go out there, but don't go past the break in the forest line, and you won't. They shouldn't know that you're there. And I was like, okay. And apparently he got in and showed his orders off to him, and they told the guard at the shack told him to that an escort would come to the gate. You follow escort in and follow escort out. If you veer from the directions of the escort vehicle, you will be arrested on the spot. Got out there. He said he went, picked up the truck, and attached it to the tow truck and dragged it out. And he said, that was the only time I've ever been out there at that time. This has been 15 years ago, 16.
Right.
Well, actually a lot more than that. Probably about 20 years ago when I heard this story. So some months later, I was married at the time, and I was telling my ex-wife that, hey, I have a day off. And I told her about the story, and I said, I'm going to go find out if this is actually true. So I went out in this little car that we had at the time. And I found the place, and he told me what to look for on the road, and I found the spot. And I drove for about 3.5 miles, and I was like, ah, this guy's crazy. And then all of a sudden, I saw the break in the forest line, which down that trail was nothing but pine trees for miles on both sides, you know, winding in and out, tall pine trees. And you see between them and stuff, there wasn't a whole lot of overgrowth unless you got next to a creek or something. And then I went and saw the break in the trees, and I was like, you got to be kidding me. So I parked on the side of the road where, you know, something could get past me. And I walked up to the tree line. I didn't get past the tree line. And I saw the actual base, the catena wire and the guard shack and the whole 9 yards. And I was like, you got to be kidding me. Went back, talked to him. I said, buddy, I wouldn't have believed you unless I seen it
right,
myself.
Right. In other words, unless you knew specifically where to look.
Yeah, I actually told this story maybe 2 or 3 months ago, and I actually looked on Google Maps.
Yeah.
And I knew where it should have been, but there's nothing there on Google Maps except for forest. That's about it.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
Of course. So. Yeah. And I bet you there's more than, if you think that's the only one that's camouflaged like that, like it exists but doesn't really exist. I bet there's a
Well,
bunch of them.
One of the caveats the gentleman told me was you would be surprised what they've got hidden in the general area here in Southwest Virginia that's federally owned that we don't know nothing about.
Yes.
So.
Yes. And you know what happens sometimes? Time goes by, people move away, and they forget people that once maybe knew about it. They die or move away, and that's it. And nobody either remembers or is around to say, hey, you know what? There was this, or we heard this. And then, of course, unless you get a source like this guy that happened to have gone there because he had to.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, it was actually to the point. What really sold me to get me out there was his story about he was questioning his own direct line of command, saying, I know the area, there's nothing out there, and he got ordered to go there anyway. I'm like, okay. So I had to find out myself, and I'm like, wow. Now there's other things that I can allude to or tell you about. My father had seen, he used to live on top of a ridge near here.
Okay.
He told me about some stuff that kind of dovetails into it, to say, says there's a lot of stuff out here that I've never seen, but he told me personally one day before he passed away, he told me that he used to do this thing called ginseng hunting. You know what ginseng is?
Yes.
And he knew a lot of patches throughout the mountains.
Mm-hmm.
And he was going to try to find new patches and stuff. And he was in the middle of nowhere, kind of scenario. Same scenario as, well, I've told you about, there's nothing but woods all over the place. And he was one of these mountain men that would go out trekking just because he could find out what was there. And he said he got out in the middle of this forest line. And he said the only person that he thought he'd run into was either a hunter or a federal agent or something like that for forestry service.
Right.
And he came on another field, and he said that I came on this flat field that was clear cut of all trees. But in the middle of this field was these huge, he called them tubes, but not exactly. He said it was rebarred concrete tubes that were big enough to fit a truck into. And he said there were dozens upon dozens of these things laid out in the middle of this forest, and he said there was no road to it.
So, yeah.
He said the only thing he could think of that could have got him there was a heavy lift helicopter dropped him right there. And I was like, where is this? And he said, Sean, I'd have to take you to it to show you where it is.
Right.
And where he lived was at that time was absolutely fantastic. He lived right on the crest of the ridge that overlooked a valley that you could, it was on Virginia in the Appalachian Mountains. And to look, you could see into Tennessee.
Wow.
You know, that was like 30 or 40 miles away. And you can, there is some smokestacks from a paper mill in Kingsport, Tennessee.
Okay.
That you could see. And it was just like little bitty puffs of white smoke off in the distance on a clear day.
Okay.
And you get up there. The first time I actually visited him up there when he first moved up there, I got out of my car, turned the car off, and you get out, and then all you can hear is nothing but nature and wind, and you're like, where's all the buzzing from? You know, all the background noises that we're all used to, the air conditioning, dogs barking and stuff like that. It was a stark contrast of what I was used to being up there. And he told me a bunch of UFO stuff that happened up there to him, but
we
got off on UFOs instead of
let me tell you, but you think about it, that is the perfect setting. You know, there's nothing else that when you see it, you can say, well, it was this, it was a plane, it was a satellite, because out there, like you say, it kind of narrows the field when you see something along the lines of a UFO. Okay, I know that definitely is this, or if you hear certain noises.
Yeah. I've seen a few UFOs. One of the best UFOs I've ever seen was actually where I used to live in Kingsport, Tennessee. One night with my girlfriend at that time, we came home. It was actually the first Avengers movie that popped out.
Okay.
In theaters, however long ago that was, 2007, I guess,
something like that.
And we just got home, and I was living in this little house and had this huge oak tree that was maybe 75 years old, big tree. And for whatever reason, I looked up, and this big bright light was above it. And I was like, what the heck is that? And I sort of looked down and then looked back up, and then all of a sudden I seen this red strobing light, which was a weird strobing light, and then two other lights behind it, and it covered the sky at the time. And I'm like, what in the world was that? And I got a good long look at it, and I pointed my iPhone up at it and tried to take a film of it. And you can hear, now I actually still have the video of it, but you can't see what I was looking at. You can hear me and my girlfriend at the time discussing what it looked like.
Okay.
In the last few frames of the video, you can see three or four dots, and I have to go back and look. Three or four dots in the last couple of frames. Now, I was pointing this thing at it, my iPhone, but it never really showed anything until you got to those last three or four frames. Literally, three or four frames is all I caught of the thing. And it was completely silent. And after I had my eyes on that thing for a good 5 minutes.
Okay.
And I actually reported it to NUFORC, the NUFORC, the National UFO Reporting Center.
Okay. .com.
I still have the link for the actual UFO report, but I did not send them the actual file for it. For whatever reason, I can't remember. But after I lost sight of it, this huge helicopter comes out of nowhere. And I'm used to hearing helicopters where I work in the healthcare field with the medevacs and stuff that would come out.
Right, yeah.
And the chopper wash and the blade sounds was a lot heavier than the medical helicopters. And it comes out of probably a parallel. It came over top of my house, then cut a left and went behind my house and kept going straight toward a paper mill in the direction of a paper mill I was telling you about earlier.
Mm-hmm.
And this chopper comes out of the behind me going toward in the same direction as this UFO, which I liken to that TR-3B that everybody talks about in the UFO community. And when I see videos and photographs of stuff, I look at it and compare it to my memory of what I saw. And I'm like, well, I've only seen one or two good photographs. I've not seen a video of one yet, but it compares to what I've seen.
You could say, yeah, that's what I saw.
That's what I saw. And there's only one or two that I can remember that really sticks out. But what was the big thing was three white lights on three corners, and then there was this red, crazy-looking strobe light. It was not like a strobe on top of an ambulance or anything like that. It was just the way it strobed. And I'm like, holy cow. Which, that one was one of those things that really got me going.
And you know what? And the fact that helicopter showed up when it did.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's weird.
And you can hear in the background in the video all the dogs barking, and you even can hear the neighbor's air conditioning pop on and off. And you couldn't hear anything. I could not hear anything from this particular UFO.
Right.
And I thought, well, you know, after the fact, just thinking about it, and said, if I took a rock, I could have threw it and hit it if I really threw hard.
Uh-huh.
Or got my 45 and shot at, but I was like, nah. But
I really want to find out what'll happen after this. Nah, I don't.
No.
Yeah. It's like, so, you know what? Let me ask you something, Sean. Now that you mentioned, because you know, you talk about that your dad, where he lived, and that you did, you know, and it makes me wonder if there's a paranormal slant to this or not. You know, you've heard of all these people that have gone missing in the woods and these national parks and all this stuff. Do you think? I mean, yeah, I know that there's people that just get lost. I know that it happens. You know, they lose their sense of direction. They're not familiar, and they just, and sometimes some of them, they never get found, you know, and by the time they're dead or they die, their animals pick apart the remains, and that's the end of that. But do you think that there's any, I don't want to say whether it's UFOs, extraterrestrials, what do you think might be affecting that?
I don't know. Now, I have looked into that 411 thing that
David Pilates
talks about a lot.
Yeah.
And I used to work with another guy. Let's see, what was his name? Jim Mallard on the Mallard Report.
Yes.
I used to be with him for a little while doing some news updates and stuff on Twitter for him.
Right.
And that's how I really got into it, because I was kind of recovering from the lost leg kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And I listened to David Pilates on his show one night.
Right.
And I've kind of followed him since, on and off.
Mm-hmm.
And I have a lot of questions about, you know, there's legally and statistically what the Forestry Service can report, what they follow up on. And what's politically okay, and all, there's a lot of gray area in that area. Now, is there a connection between Bigfoot and UFO sightings and all these missing people? Possibly.
Well, you know what? And it's really funny, because really, if you look at what he's done, is he's gathered information, okay?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and he does describe, hey, I've omitted people that they maybe suspect that they went out there to commit suicide. You know, he omitted all these things, and this is what I got left. Okay, and then he has these clusters. And then, of course, he presents a lot of compelling evidence as to how they're found, where they're found. You know, kind of a little bit. I find it a little bit also that he has sometimes such a hard time getting stuff back, especially about cases that sometimes are like decades old. You know, like,
mm-hmm.
who cares at this point? And in other words, that it's not an open case. It's not, you know, how sometimes you'll have law enforcement that say, we cannot give out this information because it's still an open case, even if it's an old case. No, it almost makes you think, I don't know if it's because, hey, we don't want to give you guys information to show how we've kind of dropped the ball.
Yeah.
Or, is there something more, you know, sinister behind it? If you want to get, you know, onto all the conspiracy stuff, and then again, you look at it and you say, okay, what are the chances that these many people are going to basically disappear? Because in some cases, they're never found. You know, like if you go along with what some of his theories is, like, is it Bigfoot? Are we talking, extraterrestrials? Are we talking time slips? Or are we talking rips in another dimension where these people just basically fall into another? I mean, I understand why he doesn't. He never goes and talks about that. And he's commented how sometimes they kind of try to pressure him to ask him, what do you think? You know, why do you think this is happening? And he'll very clearly state, all I'm showing is
what I found and what the inconsistencies are.
Yes.
Yeah. There's a big human trafficking
yes.
caveat that goes with that. So I especially in this area of Virginia where I live, there's a big human trafficking thing
yes.
that's happened. Yeah, especially in local news and statewide news, there's a lot of human trafficking, especially around Washington, D.C. area and the likes. And there's a lot of missing cases around that. And I think David Pilates actually mentioned that a time or two. But
right.
I kind of wonder, you know, you know, I've got a conspiracy kind of type of mind, but I also have a scientific mind where I was in the healthcare field. I've got to have all the sides lined
right.
up now.
Exactly.
It's great to jump on and say, okay, let's go down the paranormal field and say, well, this might be UFO, this might be not. I don't know. I think it may be a healthy mixture of all of the above.
Well, you know, I've even heard the theory of these are homeless people that are like, there are people that are living out in these parks, you know, and they're the ones that it's like, okay, but come on. You know, some of these people that have disappeared are full-grown adults, okay?
Right. Well, there's a case right now that's in British Columbia in Canada, and a North Carolina gal... And her boyfriend that's from Australia was doing some backpacking up in British Columbia. And this is an ongoing current case that was actually in the news this morning.
Okay.
That those two young kids, I think 17 and 19-year-old boys, is accused or is highly suspect that they are responsible for the deaths of these two hikers. And this is in local news and national news and international news since it's over the border. And the last thing I heard was these two boys are on the run in Manitoba now.
Yeah, good luck in finding them, you know, sometimes, especially, because that's a very large area that's...
Yeah, well, I'm kind of used to being in a rural area where I live, but over in Manitoba and all that stuff, that is way rural.
I mean, people don't realize, but when you look at a map and you look at Canada and you start looking up at those northern provinces, those areas like are way, you know, north of like Quebec and Montreal and out there. I mean, those are expanses that it's like, okay. I mean, you know, if they survive the winter, I mean, but.
Yeah, I'm surprised. My girlfriend's actually from Canada, and she is surprised how close the communities are from my town to the next town is of a span of like 5 or 6 miles, and she's like, well, if we're in my area, a town is like 30-50 miles away.
Yeah,
you know, you'd see a little community or a farmhouse or something in between. I'm like, wow, okay. It's really sparsely populated up through there. So if you want to get lost,
that's
a place to be.
But but again, if you survive the winter, because up there the winters are savage, the weather is very unforgiving.
Yeah, right now, like in Manitoba province, I think this morning it was like 60 degrees here, and up in Manitoba, believe it or not, was like 78 Fahrenheit.
Really?
You know. Yeah, and it's kind of crazy because of just the parallel that I'm on versus the parallel up in Canada. You think it'd be like super cold up there, but there's instances where I'm hotter or colder.
Isn't that weird?
Versus that. Yeah, it's crazy.
Yeah, that's believe it or not. Every once in a while, I start thinking about that subject, and I'm just like, if there's a very plausible, normal excuse for this, even though I still, at the same time, when you look at the sheer numbers, it's like, there's something here that just doesn't add up. But then what else could it be? It's like, man, that's like a whole different, you know.
Well one of the things, Manitoba, since we're talking about expanses, there is a huge paranormal, undisclosed happenings that goes on up there. UFO, Bigfoot, Dogman, you name it.
Yeah.
Manitoba is littered with all kinds of Indian tribes.
They have
and
a lot
stuff
of also the beliefs of the Wendigos and everything like that, right?
Mm-hmm. Wendigos. I've heard of several good Dogman stories up through there. Two people about the same exact Dogman occurrence.
Really?
Up there. Yeah.
What happened?
Because
believe it or not, I want to interrupt you real quick.
Sure.
Dogman scares me. I mean, we could talk about Bigfoot, and I'd probably wig out if I saw Bigfoot, but Dogman scares me.
Well, there's so many different aspects of Dogman. What is it exactly? Is it a figment of the imagination? Is it an actual creature, flesh and blood, that you can put a bullet in or a rock through or whatever? Or is it a possessed being? Or whatever. Now, the story I got was actually from my girlfriend.
Okay.
This actually happened Halloween night, and she was driving home. And I confirmed this with her. I said, were you drinking or anything when you did this? Because they were coming back from a Halloween party.
Okay.
And they were driving on this road, which, of course, we just discussed how sparsely populated it is. So there's nothing but woodlands and flatlands. And it's sort of like being in Illinois, you know, how flat Illinois is.
Yes.
And how flat your area is.
Yeah,
and, but it's like that. So she was coming home with her girlfriend. They were conversing back and forth. And like I said earlier, she's one of these gifted people that's spiritually connected. And they were driving home, and it got real quiet. She said that she got this gut kick that something was going to happen.
Okay.
And she comes up on this, it's a power pole, but what they call the electrical poles up in Canada is hydro poles.
Okay.
And had a light on it and said that they seen this thing was 8 or 10 feet tall. Hairy, kind of greasy looking, wet, up against the power pole, kind of in a squatted position. And said that they passed it and they got really eerily quiet. And went past it. You know, I don't know how fast it was. I would assume, knowing her, she'd probably slow down just a little bit, then took off and went to her house, and then sped into the house. And her mother and her brother were at the house, along with her dog and her mother's dog. And her brother come out, and they told him the story, and they jumped in the car with Cordy. I've actually talked to her brother and her mother about this incident on my show, actually. And it's fascinating to get the same story from three different perspectives. And they all talk about it. And the mother was left behind at her mother's, at her house. So she was babysitting the dogs.
Okay.
And her brother jumps on in. And the girl that was with my girlfriend was the girlfriend of her brother at the time.
Okay.
So they were sitting there talking back and forth about what it was. And they went loaded with what her brother refers to. We were packing steel, which which has weapons or whatever. But
yeah,
Manitoba
exactly.
has a lot of, you know, they have a lot of gun control up there, so they don't talk about what they're packing.
Yeah, of course, yes.
So they go back out, and I think it was, they came in with her truck, and I think they went out with, I think, her brother's car, if I remember the story correctly. And they went back to the same general direction where they saw this huge, beastly, 8 to 10 foot tall, you know, dog man.
It was still there.
Well, no. Actually, when they got to it, they saw this big bull, as she called it, a bull, B-U-L-L,
uh-huh.
in the middle of the road.
Uh-huh.
And she looks... You know, they kind of slowly pass the bull and turn around, and there, you know, of course, you have to know her brother. He gets really excited because telling a story, and I actually had him on my podcast for an hour and just literally just talking to him. He's one of these excitable people, but he really gives a lot of energy into the interview, and he's, oh, man, I was looking for this big hairy beast, and this bull's right there, and I'm like, oh, and...
He's looking for dog man. He gets a bull.
He's he's one of these fellows that really likes to tell stories, and he gets really energetic in it. And you have to, it's like herding cats with this particular fellow. And I love him to death, but he's one of those fellows that you just have to keep him on track. So they pass this bull, and they can turn around and pass the bull again, but they can't find the guy. Now, the story doesn't end there. Let's see, a few days later, my girlfriend said she went to a local grocery I think it's a post office. You know, it's so rural, you got like one spot that has like three or four different things in it.
Okay.
So she goes, and this guy was, there was a farmer there, and they were talking about cattle mutilation or something. And my girlfriend asked the guy about it and said, yeah, and said, there's a, told the general direction of where this happened, where she saw this dog man. And there was another story that attaches to this story, sort of, kind of.
Okay.
But the guy said, yeah, I had some mutilated cattle. in the same direction or vicinity of where this dogman sighting is up there. Now, that being said, you know, she sort of confirmed that there was something going on around there, and there's a lot of different Indian areas up there,
okay.
reservations.
Mm-hmm.
There. So, and she's kind of kept me secret on the reservations or even naming the reservations or okay. the tribes that are around there, because it's so rural that if you say, well, this is next to this reservation,
right.
or how many reservations are in this area,
right.
you can probably pinpoint where they are. And she wants to keep her where this happened
sure.
kind of a secret. So anyway, she kind of confirmed in her mind that there was something going on there. Now, there's another story when I was talking to her brother about the dogman sighting, and I actually saw there's a murder case that happened up through there.
Okay.
That happened on reservation land.
Okay.
And there was this one gal that was literally sliced up to the point where I actually read the article that was over this, and the reservation closed itself down. The chief and the rest of the tribal leaders closed the reservation down so nobody could go on and off.
Okay.
And the RCMP was not allowed on the property because of the treaties and stuff.
Okay.
So as soon as they closed it down, they become their own little country and all kind of stuff. But there was a young guy that was next to her that they found.
Okay.
Next to this dead body that was basically just chopped up. Stabbed, I don't know how many times, but the reports that I've heard from three or four different people
mm-hmm.
that this was more than just being stabbed. This was like somebody just literally butchered with
okay.
some razors or something like that. But there was a young kid that was found next to this dead body alive, covered in blood, but nude. And this kid is still in jail, serving out the murder charge for this. But along with this murdered victim,
mm-hmm.
There was three other ladies that were accosted that was, I think, part of the tribe.
Right.
And they disappeared. But I don't think they were killed or harmed or anything other than being accosted by whatever the patsy was, this kid that was found bloodied, covered in blood.
Well, let me ask you
something.
When these women that were, what did they describe?
That's the thing. As soon as the tribal leaders closed down the reservation, you didn't hear anything from them.
Oh.
They were never heard from again. How I got the three different ladies that were accosted during this altercation
right.
was from news article. And I asked about it, and I said, where's these three ladies
right.
from? And the resources that I actually talked to said never heard from them again. So more or less as the tribe absorbed these three ladies and didn't allow them outside the reservation.
Yeah.
But a lot of my stories, from a lot of the good dogman stories and stuff, come from up in Canada. Now, there's a lot of scuttlebutt. We were just talking about a dogman sighting kind of down
Texas.
On the Texas.
Yeah.
Mexican.
Mm-hmm.
I know a fellow by the name of Dark Waters. That's his. It's his name that does a lot of dogman
mm-hmm.
stories.
Right.
I've heard a bunch of stuff through him about this, but there's a lot of Wendigo kind of little people stuff that happens up on Canada, and I've heard all kinds of Bigfoot
right.
and dogmen and little people kind of stories from up through there. And I've actually did a series of podcasts based off of this one Indian.
Okay.
He actually spent. I think I got like 8 or 9 hours of him just telling stories.
Okay.
And he told me a ton of stories based off of when he was a little kid up to, I think we stopped about when he was like 21.
Okay.
He started when he was a little kid, and the way he was telling me was in progression from
okay.
when he was a little kid to older. I haven't talked to him in the last few months. I need to give him a call.
Okay.
But he was telling me about some Bigfoot stories concerning his grandfather. And his grandfather did not speak English or French or anything like that other
right.
than the local tribal language.
Right.
And I said, how did you communicate with your grandfather? And he said, well, I knew a few words, but we communicated by hand signals. And he was telling about a Bigfoot sighting when he was a kid. Oh no! This is off same Indian that was talking to. But the Indians in Canada want to refer to themselves as Aboriginals.
Right.
So he was telling me about a story he heard from a bus trip that he was going to a large city. And I'm kind of restricted to tell what province. He wouldn't even let me tell you what province it is.
Okay.
So he was amongst a bunch of friends returning from this big city on a field trip that it was overnight field trip or something like that. And then the guidance counselor / teacher was telling stories. They were kind of doing the guy thing of telling stories kind of to get pastime away. And the guidance counselor was telling the story about when he was a kid in the same general area that he was with his grandfather hunting deer.
Okay.
And he was younger and walked out into the forest with his grandfather, and they were trying to scare up deer in this particular woodland. They were following along the trails and stuff. And his grandfather and this guidance counselor, who was a young kid at the time, got separated. And they were trying to hunt these deer. And he got to the point where he got lost. And he said... that to himself said, my grandfather said, if I ever get lost, don't get afraid, be afraid, that's how you get hurt. He said I found a stump and sat down on the stump and collected my thoughts. And he was a young kid, I guess about six or seven, something like that, going hunting. And said the first thing he noticed was this odd smell. He said it was like a stinky ape kind of deal.
Okay.
And he looked up and he saw, like, maybe 30 or 40 yards away was this hairy, stinky ape looking out behind a tree. And he kind of looked at it, and it, I don't know if it motioned to him or whatever. For whatever reason, this kid walked toward the stinky ape to find it. And he got to the point where he found the spot where he last saw him. And then the stinky ape stuck its head outside of another tree down range from him.
Wow.
And eventually, this wound up leading him back to where his grandfather was.
Wow.
Now, that being said, I've heard another Canadian story on the other side of the continent that kind of paralleled almost to the T. This was actually a friend of mine that lives in the kind of British Columbia kind of area.
Okay.
And this happened to her. She told me basically the same story. And she was got lost in the woods, and she referenced it as a stinky ape. And she's in her 50s now. And she was telling me about this story. And she got lost in the middle of the woods, and she's crying, and then same scenario. The stinky ape stuck its head around the tree and led her back to a group of people that was searching for her. So I'm kind of, But, guys, if you want to know anything about paranormal cryptids or Indian folklore or whatever, go up to Canada, start looking through the lore up in Canada. You're going to find a lot of untapped, crazy stories up there.
They've got a lot of. As a matter of fact, when we were talking about the thing with the Wendigo, I mean, there's the part where they think it's a spirit that takes over a human, or that in some cases the Wendigo is a totally separate thing, or a creature, in other words.
Yeah, it's sort of like a possessed, vampirish kind of.
Yeah, cannibalistic kind of thing going on.
Yeah.
Like,
one of my friends, Lon Strickler, which I've had on my show a couple times.
Yes, I've spoken to Lon.
It's a phantomsandmonsters.com guy.
Right.
He's told me a bunch of stories back and forth. If you want to hear any kind of paranormal, kind of cryptid stuff, go to the phantomsandmonsters.com place.
And he's been collecting those stories for so many years. That's what I say. Decade. He's heard a lot of different things.
Yeah, he's one of those. fellas. I actually talked about my NDE with them a little bit, and one of the things, obviously, when I had my near-death experience, mm-hmm. when I woke up and I actually got to the point where I actually could put two and two together in my mind,
okay.
and I started researching near-death experiences, and I couldn't find a lot of. I found 8 people or 9 people. Okay. 9 people that I've talked to personally on the phone that had near-death experiences, but I haven't found anyone that really kind of meshed up how mine began
okay.
and ended. A lot of people that have near-death experiences will talk about the tunnel of light and all right. these people, all that stuff. That didn't happen to me. The way it began in my near-death experience was I was in a hospital room being told by a doctor that I've known for about a decade,
okay.
saying, Shawn, I'm going to have to do surgery and do an amputation of your left leg. And he said, you've got about a 30 to 40% chance to survive the surgery. And I was like, oh, my gosh. And at that time, you think you'd have a panic attack. You would think, being told that, you know, yeah. you got a better than a coin flip chance of not making it
yeah.
out of the surgery. So he gave me a bunch of medication to help with pain and stuff and said, Shawn, you just got to name who's going to take over for your power attorney. And my sister was in front of me, so I named her. And I said my piece and told everybody to love them that was within earshot.
Okay.
Fell asleep. And then I went into this total darkness for a while. Now, what happened after that was, you know, where people, you know, I've heard other stories that start out like this, but a lot of them will start out with, I see this pinpoint of light, and it blows up to where this is a tunnel of light that you walk into.
Right.
Mine started out as I was conscious in this darkness. I woke up in darkness, utter darkness, like being in the middle of a cave system with no light. At all. Wow. No dripping, no sensation, no cool, or just awake. I'm like, okay. And then this eye opens up and kind of glows in front of me. And the weird thing about this eye, it wasn't a human eye. It didn't have a human iris. It had a reptilian iris.
What? So,
yeah. And then it closed, and then I kind of drifted, drifted off in the subconscious or something like that. And then the eye opened up again after some time. I had no sense of time whatsoever during okay. this past. Then the eye opened up again, and another eye opened up again beside of it. And okay. it closed, and over a course of time, however long that was, I have no clue, because time during my near-death experience was sort of like how it has a hold on you here. You okay. can feel the passing of time. Time there is like the wind blowing. It blow forward, backward, side, spin around, all that stuff.
Okay.
But over a course of time, if I can use that term loosely,
right.
I was surrounded by these eyes, like I was in the middle of a snow globe, and the snow globe was lined with these eyes. Now, opening and closing, but yeah, that.
And is it always this reptilian type of eye that you're saying?
Yeah, reptilian type eye. Now, I woke up thinking about this. Now, my experience was a lot more vast than that. Okay. Actually, that was just the first part.
Okay.
But I started getting questioned about this, that, and the other, what happened in my life, like a life review, but it wasn't exactly like a life review. And it was endless questions, and then one question that kind of got my goat
okay.
was, if you remember in Coal Miner's Daughter, that old Sissy Spacek movie,
right.
you remember the coal community?
Yes.
That they were in.
Yes.
That they were doing this Jeep thing where they're going up and down the hill. That community actually is not that far from me in Appalachia,
oh, really?
Virginia. And one of my aunts and my sister actually lived in there after the fact. My aunt
okay.
at the time back in the day lived in that community.
Okay.
And I have one of my oldest memories is walking down this train track to. In the coal miner's daughter to this kind of feed store kind of deal.
Mm-hmm.
walked down this train track to get to this feed store where they had this old Coca-Cola bottle machine, this old Tommy thing that you had to go in and there's a lot of levers and stuff. Right. I remember getting my hand caught in that. But the, one of the questions was asked me why did I bend down at age four or five, bend down a train track to pick up a Coca-Cola bottle top. And I thought, you know, after that, I was fine just answering questions. I was like, I got really ticked off and I said, why in the hell would you want to know why I, at 4 or 5 years old, wanted to bend down and pick up it? And so I started cussing and carrying on. And I said, is this what the afterlife? At that time, I fully knew that I was dead.
Okay.
Or I suspected I was dead. So I started cursing and I said, why in the hell? Make this more PG than
exactly. It's like, okay.
So all of a sudden, all the eyes just closed except for a set of two off in the distance. Yeah. And I started making out this body that was attached to this kind of reptilian floating kind of deal in front of me. Uh-huh. But it was standing in front of this huge opal, kind of iridescent, you know, iridescent opal, but it was kind of liquefied opal, kind of shimmery, looking at it. And I was like, well, you know, I'm dead. I'm going to have to figure out what the heck I'm in. So I got, I can't say I walked or whatever. I kind of remember having a body at that time, but I got closer to this thing.
Okay.
And I was kind of curious what this thing was
looking. What is it, like an opening, like a door? Is that what you're talking
about? No, it was sort of like, it was looking through this huge window.
Okay.
You know, the old, it was about the size of a huge door that you'd go into old house. Like in my house, I have these oversized doors from the 1800s that are there. Right. It was bigger than that, but it was this huge open. And I the thing knew I was already ticked off. Because you know, I felt like I was being prodded and wasting my time and all that stuff during that episode, however long that was. Okay. And it kind of floated away from the opal, and I looked at it and it looked at me, but it, at the conversations that we had, it was not vocal. It was all mental, back and forth, being a psychic or whatever you want to call it. But I said, well, what are you looking at? And I looked inside this opal thing, and I saw someone else floating like I was floating, and they were being questioned like I was being questioned.
But it wasn't you, and it was somebody different.
Somebody different. It wasn't me. I was looking at through this.
Okay.
And I looked back at this kind of grayish, greenish looking, reptilian looking, whatever it was.
Okay.
And trust me, I've thought about this a lot. I was like, well, was it me being infected with this necrotizing fasciitis that caused me to have this kind of in-dream hallucination, or what the heck was it? But I reached out to touch to see, this obviously is some sort of weird thing that's in front of me. It's solid, but I can look through it. So I went, reached out to touch it, and my hand went into it, and that was the first sensation I had, was it sort of like it was warm. Okay. Kind of, if you could stick your hand in a warm bucket of house paint.
Okay.
You know that feeling? That consistent, viscous kind of feeling. And I pulled my hand out, and it was like when I drug my hand out, the opal kind of whatever was dragging with me. And it kind of, I can't say I was either sucked in or whatever into this opal at the time.
Okay.
All I can say was I was surrounded by this white opal. I guess if you look at it that way, that might be the white tunnel.
Okay.
Maybe. But not, it wasn't a tunnel.
Right.
It was, at that time, my senses were expanded at that time. But when I got in the opal, it was like I was overloaded with all these sensations. It didn't hurt, but it was sort of like you've been in the middle. If you've ever been in a large city like New York City, and you get bombarded with all these noises, sounds, and stuff, but well, it was all a lot more intense. And that was the last time I remember having a body at that time. And I woke up. I not woke up. I kind of got my senses back together, and there was I was no longer in that area where wherever that was with all those reptilian eyes and stuff.
Okay.
This was the first point where I actually recognized I was in heaven at that time. And there was this entity that I refer to as an angel. Okay. And I can tell you that it didn't have a name that I could speak. It was more like if you walk into a room or you're in a room for a while and you're the only person in the room and somebody walks in that you've known all your life and love and stuff, mm-hmm. and you can feel them.
Right.
And you know who they are just by feeling them, if you get my drift. That was this angel's name.
Okay.
And it didn't have a body. It was sort of like a massive light kind of deal.
Okay.
And when I tell, when I've told the story in the past, I refer to this entity as Bob. Now, just so I don't have
re-explain.
Yeah. It wasn't its name, but it's its name now.
Bob.
But Bob. So I don't have to re-explain.
Okay.
The entity I told you about that I met at the, and then I had a lot of discourse with this particular entity. It showed me all kinds of stuff. More or less, I could fill volumes of encyclopedia volumes.
But let me ask you something. Did he, or we're going to use the word he, and because you were to use the word he, did it look like what you think of as a prototypical angel? Or was it just because you think, okay, this is the closest I can think of as to what it is or he is?
When I had all the things that I experienced that I had preconceived going in. Now, I grew up in a Southern Baptist, in a Southern Baptist family. So, angels with wings and all that stuff. That was foremost in my mind, but what I was, I could say I was seeing, but I wasn't. My experience was I could see 360 around me, but I could feel everything around me. It was like I was a part of everything.
Okay.
And one of the, I could feel, sense everything in such detail and converse. It wasn't like we're conversing now, the discourse that we're having now. But it was like everything that I could instantly ask, I was instantly given the answer to. It was no question that was never... some of it I wish I could remember, and some of it I wish I couldn't remember.
Okay.
Well, some of it I kind of wonder, why did I ask that question, and why did I get that answer?
Okay.
And one of the things, every once in a while, this happened back in 2015.
Okay.
November 17th was the day I went in, 2015, went in for my amputation.
Okay.
And that... it's been that long, and every once in a while I'll go back and I'll have these spurts of remembering stuff that happened back in a near-death experience, like, oh, how did I forget this? One of the bigger things was that I remembered, I don't know why I'm saying this, but I was having a conversation with a lady that had a near-death experience but was unlike mine. She's a published author, and I can't remember her name off the top of my head. I can see her face, but we're having a conversation about her near-death experience and her connection with how she began her near-death experience, which was in the middle of, she is a big horse-loving person. She does a lot of horseback riding and is on a farm and stuff, and somehow she lost consciousness and was either kicked or something, fell off a horse. And she had a near-death experience from that. She floated above her body at that time. And one of the things that I personally, along with a lot of near-death experiencers, don't have any fear of death whatsoever. The only unknown factor is how is it going to happen when I pass away finally.
Let me ask, did you ask or were you given an explanation what it was that you saw with those eyes?
Actually, that's one of the things I've conversed with a lot of people about, and I remember having the conversation, and it was, the answer I was given is sort of like a demonic, kind of in between being alive and being dead and being in heaven and that kind of stuff. I remember that. It's like a lot of gray area.
A pretty horrific thing there that you described, let me tell you.
Oh, that, the horrific thing, that ain't even horrific. That's Well, I did not have any fear ever in this experience. But one of the things that came to mind when I was having this conversation with this lady that had a near-death experience, I had this flash that I'd forgot about. Okay. You know, we were talking about not having the fear of not dying. And then all of a sudden, I remembered having a conversation that once I realized who God was, having this conversation with God, and, you know, I remember cursing God and trying to surgically remove God out of my life at times, even cursing him. And I asked God, I said, why, after all this time, did me trying to remove you from my life, are you allowing me back in heaven in your presence? Okay. And then God just said, well, you're growing up. You didn't know what you were doing. And then he showed me, that was my life review right there. Every time that I trying to curse God or move away from God or whatever, he showed me, or if you can say he or whatever.
Right, right.
God is God. God showed me how close God was with me. And it was, you know, even though I was trying to remove God from my life, God showed me how close God was with me, even though I was denying and just throwing it out there saying, no, I don't want you in my life.
Right.
But it was closer than the skin on the back of your hand throughout the whole thing.
Right.
And I did not remember that particular thing. It kind of cemented, if you want to use that term, the reason why I don't fear dying anymore. And it all hit me all at once, that whole rather myriad of emotions, laughing, crying, the whole nine yards, the whole gamut with this conversation. I remember having a conversation with the near-death experiencer that was trying to get on my show,
right,
which I need to contact her because we never did have that show conversation. But I started crying on the phone with this lady.
Okay.
And I kind of choked back a tear or two while I was telling this conversation. But I have events where something will remind me about my near-death experience every once in a while. It's not as frequent as it has been in the past, but it hasn't happened in the last couple of 3 months. And I'll say, oh. And my girlfriend, she always quizzes me, tell me another story of what happened in your life or your near-death experience. And I'll start telling her a new tale, and she'll say, no, I want to hear about a tale I told her before. Uh-huh. I was like, well, you don't want to hear a new tale? No. And then she quizzed me one time. I was out on the back porch, and we were talking, and she said, well, tell me a new tale. And I was like, okay. And I can't remember what the tale was. It was something from my youth. And she said, I've never heard it. And I said, well, that's what you wanted to hear.
All right.
I wanted to hear a tale.
Let me ask something, Shawn. Did you ever get to that point? Because you hear a lot of people that have had those near-death experiences that basically they were okay to be dead. In other words, they didn't want to come back. They were like, okay, I'm good. It's like, you know, and they come back almost like either because they've left somebody behind or they've told you've got more work to do.
A lot of people I've talked with said that they wanted to come back or wanted to stay.
Mm-hmm.
But was told that they had to come back for whatever reason, their connection.
Right.
Now, my particular one, I remember the conversation very well. I was actually arguing with God at the time.
Why not?
And God gave to me that, you're going to move on. You're not going to go back. And I said, no, I've got to go back. And I started arguing over these eight souls.
Okay.
And I remember I've met three of them.
Okay.
And the other ones I've argued over, and I remember having an argument, but I can't remember who they were, but I can still feel the argument and know what I was supposed to. Said, no, I got to do this, I got to do this. And God said, no, just hold, to use a Southwest Virginia slang, hold your taters, they'll be here. And it's just like, yeah, they'll be here in just a moment. Don't worry about it. It'll be all right. No, I got to go back. And I remember arguing and getting kind of flustered. And then I sort of stopped and I said, no, I've got to go back. And at that time, that was the first time I actually heard anything orally out of my left ear. And God said, this is going to hurt. And the next thing I remember was falling. I had the sensation of falling. And I didn't have any sensation of being hot or cold or pain or anything like that. But as I was falling, I was getting cold. And I was falling through this darkness. And when I landed in this dark, I guess, to borrow what I, how it started, was in this cave in water. I was splashed in water. Got up, and I could hear myself breathe, and I could feel myself being water, and I was cold and and whatnot. And then after a while, something else fell in the water with me, but all I heard was this kind of rough breathing. It's hard to...
Which wasn't you, by the way, is what you're saying.
Was not me. Was not me. I could hear myself breathing, and I could feel my heart beating and all of that. But so I said, well, after all I went through, I said, I don't care who the heck are you. What are you doing in here with me? What is this place? And it's said, hold on a second, let me think. It said, I'm finally back with you again.
What?
Yeah, and I'm like, no, you're not. And then the next thing I remember waking up in a hospital that...
Sean?
What?
And you didn't see it. This thing just said, I'm back with you again, but you didn't have a visual. All you knew is it.
It was darkness, and I was in water, and I could hear the echoes and stuff. And I said, oh, no, you're not. And then that's it. Now, I've had dreams. My dream, dreaming and stuff, it's kind of weird because I wake up in the dream and know I'm in a dream because I got a left leg in my dream. And I'm like, oh, well, yeah, this is a dream. And then I become, you know, sentient in a dream, and I've had some dreams that kind of go wild, but I've had some dreams where I've encountered this particular entity. And the liking is all the stuff that I guess I got sort of kind of attached by something before I went into the near-death experience. And I've had dreams of it before. One of the dreams that I've told to a couple people after the fact, I was actually in this room sleeping, and I was back probably about 3 years ago. Turkey was going through this revolution. You know, if you remember in the news where they had, you know, the government was flip-flopped and this, that, and the other. And I was having this dream of being in the middle of this crowd that was just absolutely protesting something. They were just up in air, and you could just feel the tension and the anger and stuff. And in this dream, this dark entity jumps out in front of me, out of the crowd in front of me, and says, Sean, I need you. And I said, need me for what? And what are you doing here? I need you. And I said, no, I don't. And then it jumped back in the crowd.
What did it look like?
It was this black mass, kind of shaped in a... a lot of people, I liken it to some of the details of like the dark hat man kind of deal, but didn't have a hat on. I've had one of the others, and then I woke up and the revolution started over in Turkey at that time when the government was trying to be overthrown, and I don't know what's happening in there now. But that was distinct. And another one when I had... of this entity, I was dreaming of this place. I was walking around, and I woke up inside the dream knowing, hey, I got my left leg back. Okay, I'm dreaming this. So it was in a kind of a, at a dusk time, and in a kind of overgrown hay kind of farm scenario with some trees, and there's this old decrepit barn out in the field in the middle where you would keep horses or old hay stashes or tobacco or whatever. And I saw a kind of a flickering light in it, and I said, well, I'll just go out and see what's going on in there. And I opened up this door expecting to see the inside of a dark barn with whatever is being kept there, and there was this church inside of this. Yeah, there was this church inside of this thing, and there was a bunch of pews, and there was this altar with some candles and stuff, and it had this black statue of an angel. You know, kind of, it was just solid black, but it was in the, kind of a silhouette of an angel. And then I was looking around with it was like an old time church with a lot of pews and stuff that you would see, and you know, just room enough for about 50 or 60 people if they're sitting, and two rows of church pews. And I see this black entity in, sitting in the middle of the left hand side of this, I say church. And it kind of looked at me. Well, it looked in my general direction. I didn't really see eyes or anything like that. So I was like, well, this is a dream. I'll go find out what's going on. Sat in front of it, in the pew in front of it, and looked back at it in this dream. Hmm. And okay. it said, I need you to help me. Now, this was before the turkey thing that I was, before this, that other dream I had. And it said, I need your help. It said, we've been separated for so long, I need your help. I said, no, you don't. You don't need my help. I ain't give you permission for anything. And said, no, I need your help. It flashed a bunch of stuff in me, like a grandiose kind of things. And I'm like, no, I don't want anything like that. I'm here to help certain people, but it ain't you. And then I got up and started to leave, or not leave, I got up to go look at that angel statue. And this thing started getting really mad and hollering and carrying on and screaming and throwing the church pews and stuff. And I wasn't paying any attention. So I went up to touch the statue to figure out what the heck it is. And then it screamed out in this demonic kind of voice, and no, that's mine. And I was like, huh? So I reached out to grab a hold of the statue. I grabbed a hold of the top half.
Okay.
Of the statue, and it reached and grabbed a hold of the bottom half. And it was sort of like the consistency where it didn't break in half. Well, I guess it was broken in half. But in the dream, it separated. And it was sort of like the middle of it from like the waist up. Okay. Melted away from the waist down. It had a hold of that. I grabbed a hold of that and started running out of that barn. And this is the funny thing. I remember looking down, and I had this old pair of cowboy boots back in the day.
Uh-huh.
One of my favorite pair of cowboy boots. And I was like, hey, I haven't had those on in a while. And I was in this gravel running down holding this thing. And then all of a sudden, my left heel on the side of that I don't have a leg kind of got cattywampus, and I fell in it, and then all of a sudden I was on my back, and this what remained of the statue kind of absorbed in me in this dream.
Okay.
And then this thing said, that's mine. And then I kind of woke up out of the dream kind of startled and going, what the hell was that all about? But I'm liking it to whatever I was separated before when a near-death experience was trying to get back.
Let me ask you, that was my question prior to the near-death experience. Now that you look back, do you remember ever having similar dreams where you kind of saw the same thing, or it was only after the near-death experience?
The only thing that I had a very rich dream kind of thing where I had to... Now, my dream's a lot better than any movie out there, but there was this one dream that reoccurred over the course of my life from when I was a little boy up until months before my near-death experience.
Okay.
I had this dream of this girl that I grew up with in my dream world. Mm-hmm. Yeah, when I was a little kid, this girl was a little kid. And every few months, I'd have a dream of her. And then had a dream of this big house. Right at the last few years of it, this lady was a part of this house, or associated with this house, was always out in the yard. Big house, two-story house, kind of old 1700s, 1800s style house.
Right.
kind of deal. With a big yard and whatnot, I still wonder about it because since my near-death experience, I've never had that dream since. But it was one of those things. After I had that dream, I felt like it was home in that dream, and then I wake up. And the weird thing was, when I woke up from the dream, no matter what it was like I was in the middle of a honeysuckle patch. You know that smell of sweet honeysuckle?
Right. Yes.
It was like, that's what surrounded me for several minutes after I'd had one of these dreams. And you wake up and you go, ah, man, I wish I was back in that dream. And then it fades and that was it. Now, that being said, that was one of the reoccurring dreams I had prior to the death experience. Now, having dreams of whatever that black entity was, no, that didn't occur until after the near-death experience. And I haven't had a dream of that thing in quite a while. I don't want it, but...
No, absolutely.
I woke up after the near-death experience with a lot of stuff on my mind with what I experienced in the near-death experience and what I experienced during the hospital stay and after moving back in this house. The weird thing is I'm thinking about right now is when we were talking right before we got on the show,
uh-huh.
We were talking about all the ghost experiences and stuff I had in the hospital, and I was like, wow, we went askew.
Well, you know, it all comes back to, which I was going to get there eventually, because I know you've got some great stories, and like we were talking about, you know, hospitals are a hotbed of ghostly activity, and the ones that usually, whether they want to admit it or not, are the people that work there. You know, some have more experiences than others, but man, they see or hear certain things that are like...
There's a lot of stories out there. Just because they're in the healthcare field and there's laws against sharing certain things, so you don't get a lot of people talking about it until they retire.
Exactly. Yeah.
And I remember being regaled by this one by a bunch of people about ghost stories in the hospital.
Right.
Hospitals that I worked in. Probably a dozen hospitals I've been in,
mm-hmm.
either by association with or contracted to be in or whatever.
Right.
And I usually I hear the best ghost stories during the night shift. And for whatever reason. Oh, your little doggies don't like ghost stories, do they?
Let me tell you something. It's like, my audience already knows that they're like, I've got three puppies from a rescue. And it's like, out of a litter of six, I kept three. And I'm telling you, it's like never a dull moment. But anyway, go ahead. You were saying the hospital.
Yeah, that's hospitals are definitely hotbeds for paranormal. I liken to the people that work in the hospital care field,
right.
to ones that are absolute deniers of it, to people that are on the fence about it, that lean one way or other, but mm-hmm. and then there's people that go into the field and go that are believers, and then they get reinforced by what happens. Now, that being said, there's been a bunch of stuff that happened to me, specifically considered shadow people.
Right, yes, you made mention.
Yeah.
Yes.
One of the stories that I remember, three or four good ones, but always associated with around a person's demise, you know, passing away.
Mm-hmm.
One of the stories I've told a few times was about this. I was in ICU at one hospital, and I was doing my last rounds as a respiratory therapist in the morning to get my final data collection to report to the next shift and do whatever was ordered.
Okay.
And there was this person on a ventilator that had what's called an arterial blood gas line. If you know what an ABG is, arterial blood gas, where they stick a 23-gauge needle, which is kind of, well, it's not very big, but stick it into your wrist to gather blood gases from your artery.
Okay.
But the line, which I actually have a mark on my hand, my right hand, from where I had one when I was in a coma.
Okay.
But what they do is to save your artery from being punctured so many times and losing
right.
it,
mm-hmm.
is insert this arterial blood gas line. And there's a lot of sterile procedures, and it takes about 3 to 5 minutes, maybe longer, to do all the sterile procedures to get an actual blood out of an arterial line that is in a sterile field and all this stuff. So I was bending down next to a ventilator with the patient in the bed, and it was night shift, and the shift I was on, we did every 2 weeks kind of a potluck dinner. So we were in the mode of kind of saying, okay, what do you want to bring for potluck the next day or whatever? And one of the nurses that I was working with was notorious not to say anything if she was really into her work.
Okay. So,
I bent down and I saw this, I saw what was, I thought was this nurse come into this room out of my peripheral vision.
Okay.
But my my vision was on the sterile field. But I was talking to what I thought was this nurse, and I said, well, what do you want to bring for tonight? Or, yeah, tonight. And I didn't get any answer, and I was like, oh, okay, no problem. But after I got to the point where I was about, where I could take my sight off of my area that I was doing safely, looked up, and I saw this black mass in front of me. Standing across from it on the other side of the bed, and I, you know, how you... I was looking by the left side of this patient's left arm. Yeah. I was scanning, and I got up to the point where it was about mid-rift on this thing, the black thing. And it kind of, it wasn't like it bent down to get out of my view. It was like something grabbed it and pulled it up underneath the bed.
What?
Yeah. And it was like... it either that or this or a trap door under it just kind of opened up. But I, you know, that's what I think happened. But I looked at it and I kind of said, well, I looked down and finished what I was doing with arterial line, and made sure everything was kosher with that. And I looked out at the nurse's desk, and most ICUs are set up in a horseshoe fashion, where the desk where the nurses are, so they can visually see the entire ICU from their desk. And I was looking to see if anybody saw this or anybody was close to me. And this little lady that was 5'1", 5'2", was sitting there, and all I could see was the top of her. She was at LPN, and she was one of these old school nurses that didn't take gruff from anybody. She had her own disposition, and she didn't care to voice her what was on her mind. So I was like, okay. So I walked out to her and I said, was anybody in that room with me? And she looked up at me over her half moon glasses, her reading glasses, said, well, she said, F no, Sean, what are you talking about? You were just in there doing blood gases. And I was like, yeah, I know, but was it my error?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
She said, other than the patient, and of course she had a really gruff vocabulary.
Uh-huh.
Especially when she was thinking I was
Where
are you going with this? Kind of deal. And she said, nah, Sean. And I was like, well, okay. Well, I think that particular patient passed away 2 days later after that fact. But there was other aspects of these, or I encountered another shadow person up on a cardiac floor, same hospital, one day when I was doing oxygen rounds, probably about 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, where you go around on a clipboard and you got everybody that will, and you got a whole list of rooms. Numerically, and you go down the hallway on each floor and stick your head in each room, whether you got it on a clipboard or not, that's occupied, to see who's on what, and kind of discern whether they're on the right stuff, or did we get a notice that this person's on this particular respiratory treatment or whatever.
Right.
So I was sticking my head in each and every one of the rooms, and I got down to the point where I could turn down the left from this nursing desk.
Okay.
And my entire intention was on this clipboard, trying to figure out where I wanted to go and making connotations and stuff on the clipboard. And all of a sudden, this thing, I couldn't feel it, but I saw it out of my peripheral vision just run right past me and hang a left down the hallway. And it was this black mass. And I was like, what the heck was that? So I looked back to see if I could find it. And the only thing that I could see that would be reasonable to consider that somebody could jump into was this nutrition room that was, you know, these big, huge fire doors. If you open them up and close them, mm-hmm. they make a rather distinct sound that you can't muffle. So I looked at that, and I was like, nobody's in there. And I looked down the hallway, and I was like, okay. And I kind of shook it off and went down the hallway to finish my rounds, and all of a sudden this lady sticks her head out of the room. Help me, my husband just passed out.
Oh.
And, well, coded this particular patient for 45 minutes or something like that. We went heroic efforts on this particular patient. I seen some stuff that I hadn't seen other than in manuals okay. done on this patient to help this, kind of revive this patient. But that one was like that. Another instance where I saw this particular shadow person was I was in a monitoring room on a cardiac floor where they monitor, where they have these heart packs on them where they can monitor their heartbeats and stuff remotely.
Right.
I was in the room talking to one of the monitor techs on a break, and one of the ECG went out, like somebody just pulled a patch off or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And just, she was about ready to get up. I said, what room is it in? I'll go check it out and just put a patch back on or whatever. And she told me the room, and I went out, and as soon as the door was closed to the hallway that was right on the other side to get into the patient care area room hallway.
Okay.
So I opened up the door, and this shadow thing went right past me, zoom.
Wow.
I was like, what the heck? And I went to the room, and and I was like, well, where is this person? Uh-huh. And I was about ready to leave the room, and I just said, well, I'll go look on the other side of the bed. And I saw this half-cocked foot between the footboard and the mattress, and this person was laying dead there.
What?
Yeah. And I'm like, okay, so we coded that person, didn't make it back, but there had been, I've seen some other shadows and stuff.
But let me ask, the person had what, passed away and nobody had realized it because...
Well, it was the person I went to fix the ECG monitor, the heart monitor on.
Okay. Well, now I understand. Okay, so basically it was like... What?
Yeah. And I was getting up to go do, a good deed and say, hey, don't worry about it. I'll go.
Just thinking it's one of these monitors that's come off.
Yeah, just come off or something like that. It's nothing in the middle of the night to see something go flatline. You're like, okay, well, I'll go look at it and replace it or whatever. Some people just, kind of fight in the middle of the night and pull off every wire they got on them. Yeah. That's what I was thinking. So.
Well, you know what? A couple of years ago, I was doing this tour and, people come up to you and tell you stories, and there's this one guy comes up to you, and it's the same thing. He wasn't working in the medical field, but it was the same thing. He was working like that overnight shift kind of deal.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think it was ICU. I just don't remember, honestly. But anyway, he says that usually was very quiet. And he says, minimal staff, and it was like a floor, basically. And he says, after a while, you look at your patients and you know what's going on with who.
Mm-hmm.
And he says that him, I think, and he said two other nurses or something like that, they're at that station. And all of a sudden he says, you heard a woman scream, not like scared scream, like bloody terror, like that they all looked at each other. He said it was really weird because it was on the floor, but it was really difficult to determine where it came from. So he was the only one that volunteered. He says, I got to go look. To see what's going on, where did this come? So he says, it wasn't he. I guess from what he told me, it wasn't that he had that many rooms. Basically, he went up and down, and from what he was describing, it was from the way that nurse's station was. They had kind of like a clear vision in both directions of the hallways that led off.
Mm-hmm.
And he says he went into each and every room, and he says everybody, although the patients were okay, most of them were asleep. There was nothing. And they never were able to explain. He says the two nurses there, they were like so. And he says you saw exactly a lot of times exactly what you described, shadow people, or stuff like that at the end of the hallways. And he says after a while,
yeah.
People, they don't want to investigate. They don't do what you did. Forget it.
Well, that reminded me about, I've got two stories that are, one is about experiencing an NDE with a patient that I just revived.
Really?
Well, I've got two stories like that. The one that sticks out, and then there is one that when I first started as a respiratory therapist, at my first job ever in this little rinky-dink 40-bed hospital, and I went into this room with this little old lady, can't remember the name or anything like that, but I walked in, and there was medication nurse was doing her rounds. And we were kind of tagging along with each other. I would go in one room, give them breathing treatment or whatever, and she'd come in, and we were kind of going back and forth. And I went in the room before her, the medicine nurse, and said, "My name's Shawn, yada, yada, yada. I'm here to do whatever breathing treatment for you." And the little lady looks up at me and said, "No, I don't need the breathing treatment. The nurse just come in and gave me one." I was like, well, I was only one on duty on that floor.
Like,
no. And she adamantly said, "No, I've already been given my breathing treatment." And she explained to me who it was. And at that time, when I was in healthcare, started healthcare, nurses were still wearing those nightingale hats that were so prevalent back then. Nowadays, you don't see them a whole lot. But she explained the look of the lady and stuff like that. And I went out and told I had to tell the medicine nurse that she refused medication from us, the respiratory side. And I said, "Did you give her anything?" And she said, "Nope." I said, "I'll tell you here in just a second." She walked in, and that lady refused her too. Said, "No, this nurse already gave it." And she come back out and told me the story. Said, every once in a while, right before a patient passes on the floor, they'll see this nurse that was there when the inception of this hospital that died on duty in this hospital. And she said, this has happened to me several times, and I was warned about it and stuff, that they'll see this nurse come in and give them medication, and they'll say the same thing, describe them to the T about the whites, nursing outfit.
So this wasn't that one patient that was just having like, "Hey, you're hallucinating and you're thinking somebody's giving you treatment."
Wow. Yeah, I was, I was young and thought I knew everything about respiratory, and and you get encounters like this, and you're like, "What the heck?"
I'm going to ask you the magic question: did that patient die soon after, or did you?
To my knowledge, I think they did, because just the conversation I had with this nurse, I don't recall specifically if they passed away, but she was she was old enough to not say she wasn't going to pass away.
Right.
But I have seen other people like that would, a lot of things that would reoccur, like with patients that I dealt with over the years as a respiratory therapist on their deathbed, would tell me, that there are the people in the room and say, "Well, my uncle's over there, but I don't know why he's over there. He's been passed for ever and a day." And I've actually had that happen to me personally with family members that have been on their deathbed and call out for long passed away folks.
Yes.
And unfortunately, I stayed with my grandmother for over a year. And as she was in her, final days, she was in the middle of the night calling for her daddy that had... Now, I remember as a little boy, my great-grandfather, and I went to the funeral and all this stuff, and I remember her calling out for daddy in the middle of the night. And I'm like, wow. And this particular house that I'm in, this place had a lot of paranormal stuff going on during that time. Now, it was kind of weird and eerie, and to hear her calling out for these people that... Some of them I've heard of, and some of them I knew, and some of them,
Right, you knew, right. It was maybe they had passed on before you were. One time I had a ghost hunter. Her daytime job was a hospice nurse, and she told me, "You know what, Marlene? once I had certain patients that she had done it for several years, whenever they start doing exactly what you described, Shawn, they start talking to this certain person that sometimes she knew, by the way, because of, you know, she got to know the family, that this person was deceased. It says when they start doing that, I know that it's very shortly they're going to be passing away.
Oh, yeah. Well, it hasn't happened in quite a bit since I've been living in this house by myself for a while. But upstairs, where I live on the first floor, upstairs I heard people walking back and forth upstairs, and knowing that nobody's been upstairs in days and days. And I haven't heard it upstairs in the last little bit, but I've heard people, and it sounds like people upstairs walking around.
And what was the upstairs used at, as bedrooms or what?
Yeah, bedrooms. There's one, two, three. There's four bedrooms up there. One's converted into like a bathroom / mm-hmm. sitting room.
Right.
Kind of deal. At the top of the stairs. Well, I think I told this story to you right before the program started.
Mm-hmm.
But there's this little old lady that haunts upstairs. And okay. She used that. To my knowledge, this is who I think she is. Before my grandparents bought this place, they lived in the property adjacent to this on the property line, and they kind of swapped places and whatever it was to swap the properties. And I remember this little lady with the great-grandson of the original owner of this place that owned the... There was a grocery store, one of the first grocery stores in the region, that is on the footprint of the property is where I park cars in my yard now.
Okay.
But it was a two-story kind of establishment. But I remember as a kid seeing this little lady that I think she passed away when she was 100 and something.
Okay.
And I remember her coming out of the back door in the middle of summer, dressed in a big heavy house coat and one of those big sunbonnet kind of hats, you know, big sun, you know, people wear, don't want any sun on their skin.
Right.
She'd come out and look at the old owner of this place and look over his garden he had in the backyard. And I remember seeing her like that. And I do remember several times when I look upstairs in the second floor in this house, outside when I was a kid before we owned this property,
right,
seeing somebody standing in one of the rooms up there. And nobody was up in that room for various reasons, just because of, you know, the only people that was up there was, you know, the old man that used to own this place and his mother that passed away,
okay,
kind of stuff. But the old lady, I've had conversations with my family, and my sister and my niece was here probably about springtime of this year.
Okay.
The first of spring. And I was telling her some ghost stories. They had heard one of my podcasts. I was telling one of the ghost stories in this house. And my niece has two sons that are toddler age.
Okay.
Three and five, I think, is the age right now of them. And they won't allow any of the toddlers upstairs because of the ghost activity.
Sure.
So I was like, oh, really? I'm sorry about that. And so they knew about this house.
So you think that little old lady upstairs is the little old lady that used to live there?
I believe so. One day, to retell the story I've already told you just for your listeners, one day when I was going to college, I was living here along with my grandparents, going to college full time and working full time. And I was coming home from a clinical at a spot in Tennessee, in Kingsport, Tennessee. And I was coming off what we called an evening shift rotation for the clinical. And by the time I walked through the door, it was well after midnight. So front door is on the other side of this wall that I'm in right now, but room I'm in. But right in front of the front door is the staircase, and then you can go down the hallway, and there's two bedrooms on the side. So I walked in a little between 12 and 1 a.m., something like that. And I walked in, and I was trying to be as careful and as quiet and try not to wake up anybody. So I didn't turn any lights on. and I was using the outside street lamps to illuminate the staircase. And there was a picture window at the top of the staircase that I used to negotiate the stairs to get up and go to my bedroom up there. And I got up 3 or 4 steps, looked up for whatever reason, and there's this little lady, like 5 foot nothing, looking down at me, and she's dressed in this period, late 1800s period dress with a gray, long, ankle-length dress on.
Okay.
Sort of like she was dressed to go to church, but I would assume, but had one of those high collars with those opaque cameo necklaces on.
Okay.
And her hair was up in a bun, looking down at me like, well, who are you and what are you doing here? And I'm looking up at her, and I'm like, I don't know you.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And for whatever reason, I didn't scream or say, hey, who the hell are you up there on top of my step? And there's a serial switch at the bottom first step, and I was feeling for it, and I locked eyes with this thing for a good 45 seconds to a minute trying to find this thing. Popping, I've almost lost my footing trying to stretch to find the serial switch, and I just so happened to look back and saw, I was just inches away from the switch to turn the light on, and I popped the light on, looked up, and the thing was gone. And I went upstairs, turned the other serial switch up at the top of the stairs off, and I went around the staircase and into my bedroom and closed the door. Now, that being said, while I was here on Sundays, while I was working, morning to night,
okay,
either going to school and work or work and school and whatnot. And Sundays was my only days off. So I relished those days, and I would sleep in. That was my days to do. Sleep in. So I was sleeping in on several occasions. And one occasion, I was sleeping in, and I heard this faint voice singing a hymnal without music. You know, in the Southern Baptist, you'd have these hymnals hymns that the whole group would sing along and stuff. And it was that seesaw-y kind of singing. And I thought, well, my papa was notorious for little radios. He loved little radios, and they were all over the house, in the basement, outside in his work shack, that whole 9 yards. And I thought, well, that old thing is, he left one of those radios on the gospel station. Now I went back to sleep listening to this woman singing. And I woke back up and heard my grandparents apparently was coming back from church. And I smelled KFC chicken. I was like, okay, it's time for me to get up and come here. So I went downstairs and saw my grandmother in her Sunday dress. And she was unloading 2 big sacks of KFC. And I was like, hey, where's Papa at? And she said, he's out in the car doing something. And I was like, well, he's left one of his little radios on. And said, well, you can tell George here in a little bit and see where it's at. And Papa just came in through the kitchen door, which I was standing in the entrance to the kitchen from the dining room. And he looked at me. He said, what are you talking about, son? And I said, one of your little radios is on. I heard a hymn being sung for a good 30 minutes. And he said, no, he said, there's no radios on around here. He said, you got to be nuts. And I was like, no, I heard it. He had this little cube radio that it was portable, about the size of a big softball, but it was cube. I said, where's that little cube radio at? And it was like a magician. He reached behind the door, behind this door hallway, pulls this cube radio out, and he says, is this one you're talking about? And I was like, yeah. I said, no, that's been off. And I said, was any other radios on? No.
There goes that theory. Yeah.
And, there goes that theory. But I had heard several times of a little lady singing a hymn in this house and disembodied voice singing. I haven't heard it since I moved back in here, but I've heard several voices in this house that I'd wake up or in the middle of the day hear something or see something and go, what did I just see?
Right.
And my girlfriend that I referenced earlier, she, one of the first days she was with me in the house alone, and she woke me up in the middle of the night. Have I told this story on air, or was this?
No, no, go ahead. No.
Oh, okay. So in the middle of the night, she woke me up and said, "Sean, there's somebody, two women, and whispering out in the hallway." And yeah, this place doesn't have central air, so I've got a window unit air conditioner. The window. So we had the door closed to the hallway just to keep the air in. And she said, she woke me up, told me about these two ladies. I said, "Oh, don't worry about it. It's probably somebody out in the street talking." She said, "Not at 3 a.m. in the morning."
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And I kind of passed it off because, you know, I live here alone, and this kind of stuff don't bother me anymore.
Right.
I fell back asleep, and then she wakes me up, shaking me, and said, "Now they're banging outside and still whispering." And I was like, "What are you talking about?" And I listened. I heard some banging, but I didn't hear the whispering, but I don't doubt that she heard it. So I try to console her. And I said, "Oh, just go back to sleep."
It's like, sure.
And then she buries her head in between my shoulder blades.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
Grabbed a hold of me like she's grabbing me like a bear hug.
Yeah,
and I woke up and said, I think I dreamt that you woke me up telling me there was ladies out in the hall. Yes, they were. Matter of fact kind of deal. And I'm like, "Oh my God, sorry about that." But there has been some interesting things happening in this house.
Right, and you're like, yeah, and I'm used to it. That's
I'm
why.
Used to it.
Yeah.
Now, before the NDE, if I was living here now before the NDE and I didn't have the NDE or the whole nine yards, I'd probably be spooked out of my gourd, because I remember living here being spooked out of my gourd.
Yeah.
And with people in the house.
Right.
And thinking, what the heck's going on here? But now, since the near-death experience, it doesn't bother me. I know where these things came from, and it doesn't bother me whatsoever. Now, one of the things I have noticed doing this paranormal podcast stuff that I've been doing since May of 2018, I've noticed if I talk to certain guests, now I'm not going to name guests or anything like that, but if it's on a particular paranormal subject like demons or what, well, I'll pick on one of the fellows I just talked about, Dark Waters. He came on my show. And he's big into paranormal and cryptids, dogmen, and stuff. He was telling about a particular instance about a demonic entity that was around his house.
Okay.
And he named that entity on air. And as he was naming the entity, at the time, it was before I had my microphone set up I've got now. It was a condenser mic, and condenser mics pick up echoes like crazy.
Right.
So I had to find out how to get rid of the echo in my microphone. So I stuck my microphone set up and the computer and everything in my closet, surrounded by the clothes in the closet, to get rid of the echo.
Right.
So I had a little stick lamp beside of me, illuminating my keyboard and all that stuff. And as he named this entity, this demon, which it don't bother me now. I'm not going to name the name, but he named it, and then he said, all of a sudden, said, "Oh, now I've really got to tell the story," because something was tugging at his shirt, which I'm like, okay. While he's talking to me on air, and all of a sudden, I'm looking down at my keyboard, and it was well illuminated by the stick lamp. That's probably about 5 feet tall, and I'm in my wheelchair looking at my keyboard, and this shadow comes over top of my head. Over top of my keyboard, and I'm like, "What?" So anyway, I had a lot of instances after that to where there was some, I guess, either poltergeist or stuff. I've had pictures pulled off my wall and thrown in the floor and stuff. I've actually got one captured on camera where I'm rolling by in the hallway, and there was these two, you know how these little sconces you can put, but it was not a sconce. It's a like a little ledge that you can tack onto the wall and put a picture on. Mm-hmm. Well, I've had one of those that had been on that wall for easily 10 years plus.
Okay.
And I was about ready to do a show to tell ghost stories like I'm telling to you on, I can't remember the show. But anyway, I was about ready to go do the show and tell ghost stories for 2 hours. And I rolled by, and all of a sudden, I was on the phone with my girlfriend, and you hear this big smash behind me, and I'm looking back, and there was this big, long, lengthy, 100-plus-year-old table that was real thin that you can put pictures and stuff on.
Right.
And something had pulled this little ledge with a picture of Christ on it down off of it. Now, I looked at the footage from my security camera in the hallway that looks at the front door, and it was like something grabbed a hold of the perch that the picture was on and pulled it directly down. It wasn't like it was, you know.
And let me ask you this, how long ago was this, after that conversation you had with Dark Waters? Was it like right after? I mean,
this was probably weeks after.
Wow.
That I had that conversation. Well, the podcast that we did that day, we kind of did a prayer of protection after the podcast.
Okay.
And it's tagged on the actual podcast recording, so if anybody listens to it, hopefully nothing will happen. But I've told ghost stories since.
Okay.
Was it last Halloween? Yeah, last Halloween.
Okay.
Somebody, I was in a voice chat on Discord.
Okay.
If you know Discord.
Yes, yes.
I was telling ghost stories in this Discord voice chat, and they said, well, how long can you tell ghost stories for? I said, I don't know, and it's Halloween night, and I said, why not?
Okay.
So I spent like 2.5 hours, and I told one ghost story after another, and before, if you remember, the paranormal show host Heather Wade, when
yes.
she was still active.
Yes.
I called it to her in the middle of me doing this ghost story.
Okay.
Roundabout, and told another ghost story and come back and started telling ghost stories. And I felt something kind of scratched the back of my leg while I was talking on the talking on air with everybody. And I was like, what is this? And I reached down to, you know, I thought, well, maybe I tagged something on my wheelchair or whatever.
Right.
And I've got pictures of this on the back of my calf. There is like 5 scratch marks, almost equal distance, in a circle. You know, about two. Hold on a second. Let's see if I got. I ain't looked at it in a while. No, I don't have any scars from it. But I've got the actual picture of the marks on the back of my leg, and I was like, oh my God. So I did a lot of prayers after that, and it hadn't happened, but there wasn't nothing there.
Did you remember what story in particular you were saying when that happened, or you know? Or
I told the one about DW. And
It was when you were, I was
referencing that one, and I told one I was referencing about, well, there's 2 near-death experiences I had with 2 different people. One I refer to as a heaven near-death experience, and another one as I refer to as a hell near-death experience. I think I told the hell one.
Okay.
But it took a while for those scratches to heal up, if I remember correctly.
That is.
So, anyway, one of the things I do... quite a lot during the course of the day, just because, is say prayers a lot.
Yeah.
You know, it's just one of those things I do. And I say a lot of prayers of protection, especially around this house, since my niece and sister told me about they were afraid for the kids to go upstairs. So I say a protection of prayers for anybody enters the house and leaves the house. So I'll say a lot of stuff like that. And, you know, since the activity in here has ramped way down since I've done specific types of prayers to keep the paranormal activity. Now, whether you believe that or not, that's up to you, but that's the way it works for me and works for the people around me.
But, right.
You want to hear another ghost story that happened in here?
Well, I want you to tell the one which... when I did my interview with you, which I think was a great story, that you talked about that neighbor of yours, or I guess your grandparents, that used to kind of have a problem with the drinking.
Oh, okay.
Oh my God. That is such a great story.
Okay. Well, this connects back to my dreaming, you know, having dreams of waking up in the middle of dreams and stuff.
Right.
There was this guy, and he was famous in the area He was well known as being the, you know, big into baseball for the town, and you never seen him without the town's baseball mascot hat on.
Okay.
Or, yeah, the baseball outfit, the shorts and all that stuff. And I kind of, you know, when I was a teenager, I didn't really pay attention to it, but I got wind of, you know, his drinking and okay. stuff like that. But his property is right adjacent from me. I'll share a fence line with his old property that now is abandoned and is now taken down, shorn down to the ground.
Okay.
But one day, one of my routines was back then was to get up 7 a.m., 8 a.m., and go get a drink, and just start drinking coffee, eat breakfast, and do my mass consumption of whatever news topic or paranormal story I want to get into at that time.
Mm-hmm.
And I really don't have anything that would cause me any grief, per se, during that time
right.
to have any gloom or doom on me. And one, and all of a sudden I get this end oh my God, this, you know, this life ain't worth having. And I get this big, massive, gloomy feel, and I was about ready to put my head on the kitchen table, and I was like, wait a minute, why am I feeling like this? And all of a sudden, when I thought it, that what is this mine, the feeling left me, and I was okay. And I heard some banging and pecking out in the yard, and I looked out the kitchen curtain, and they were starting to dismantle the old house that belonged to this long-past fellow. And I never really put two and two together, and then about an hour or two later that same day, I was in the kitchen doing something, and in the dining room, there stood this guy, probably about 5'6", in this wife beater t-shirt.
Yeah, yeah, uh-huh.
And high water pants up to right below his navel.
Uh-huh.
And standing there, and I kind of looked and glanced and looked back and then looked again, and I'm like, what the heck was that? And I seen it over a course of several days, and I finally asked one of my family members, and I kind of put it together that it might be something that I may know, but I didn't know who it was. And then one of my family members referenced the guy's name that owned that house that's been dismantled. And I was like, yeah, that did look like him.
And that's the thing. So, you had never seen this person prior to them doing the house. It was afterwards.
It was after they started dismantling this thing. And I every time I would see this thing, I would get this kind of doomish, gloomish kind of deal. And I finally started praying about it. And this was when I first started really living alone by myself. And I said, you need to find God and go toward the light, and started praying about it and stuff. And it kind of slowed down me encountering this thing. Or whatever this.
How long had he been dead, Shawn? Did you ever know how long he had been dead by the time he started doing that thing with his house?
Probably a decade. How I, in my mind, tied this gentleman with this ghost was my grandparents, my grandfather used to take care of this gentleman when he would get on with drunks. One story in particular that I remember, this particular gentleman that had passed out drunk in a ditch during winter and was covered with snow. My grandfather, being the type of man he is, you know, took him in, warmed him up, and sent him back to the house to make sure he's okay.
Right.
And one of the things that I remember right before all this stuff stopped with seeing this particular ghost was I was asleep.
Okay.
In my bed, and I woke up in the dream, and I started to get up. I heard somebody in the kitchen, and all of a sudden I started standing up, and I had my left leg, and I said, wait a minute, I got my left leg? Okay, this is a dream. And I was like, I walked into the kitchen, and there stood my grandfather walking out of the kitchen going toward the back door to go outside. And I said, hey, Papa, that's what I used to call him.
Mm-hmm.
What are you doing here? And he's like, oh, I had to take Homer home, which was the name of the gentleman.
Right.
And said, I just got to go back. And I was like, okay, well, it was good seeing you. He kind of, he was like this 5'2" old guy that was basically a kid stuck in an old man's body. You know, he'd when he'd get some kind of a sneaky notion in his head, he always have this kind of half-cocked grin on his face, and he kind of grinned. He said, hey, you want to go for a ride? And I was like, well, this is a dream. Why not? So I walked out with him on the back porch and went out to outside, and there was this old Ford LTD black car that he used to have back over a decade and a half ago. And I was like, okay. And my sister was standing there. And my grandmother was in the front passenger seat, and he said, okay, kids, get in the car and let's go. So we jumped in the car, and my sister was looking at me in the back seat and said, Sean, is it okay for him to be driving? And I said, this is a dream. Don't worry about it. So I can remember that every inch of the drive to the destination point. At the point, he didn't tell us what the destination was. And I remember having a memory of me being in the backseat of that car when I was a kid, right, with an old Star Trek cheap phaser thing with a push the button and light, and it makes noises. And I said, if I had that laser in my phaser in my hand, that would be cool. And my grandfather, I was kind of keeping track where he was driving.
Okay.
And I said, hey, Papa, where are we going? And he said, we'll get there in a minute. And I noticed where he was driving. He's driving toward his old church.
Okay.
So he runs out to the church, and my sister, as the car stopped, my grandparents jumped out of the car and went to the back entrance to the meeting hall in the back of the church, where they did all the cooking and cleaning stuff for the church. And my sister said, well, what do we do? And I said, well, you follow Grandma or Mama, and I'll follow Papa, and we'll see what happens. So both of them darted in. My sister darts in, and then I see Granny go off to the left. Papa jump off to the right, and my sister runs after Granny, and I run off trying to follow Papa. But as I was walking in, you know, I've been in a church a few times,
okay,
and it's a small church. It's, you know, in that area, you probably get 15, 20 people,
mm-hmm,
you know, doing their cooking, cleaning, or whatever for the meeting. And instead of seeing that, I see this big cathedral, huge place, yes, with all these people standing, laughing, talking, sitting, and Papa being his little 5'2", 5'3" gentleman. I liken it to, if you remember the Christmas story with Ralphie with his Red Ryder BB gun jumping around in the house to go outside.
Uh-huh.
It was like him. He's got a jackrabbit running through the back of his cathedral. And I finally called up to him, and he was just dancing away. And I said, Papa, I said, what are you doing? He said, I'm dancing, son. What do you think I'm doing? And he grabs a hold of my hand, and I start dancing with him. And then he stops, and he points down at his shoes. And he's one of these fellows that had specific shoes for specific things.
Right.
And he had on a pair of old brown leather shoes that he wore for church. And he pointed at his shoes. And I was like, okay. And I looked down, and there was like a drop of water kind of spot that popped up on the leather of the shoe. And it got darker, and he put his foot down, and that dark spot kind of grew and went up his legs and then kind of started engulfing him. And I was like, Papa, you got to go away. And he said, yeah, I've seen a little bit, though. And he faded away. And I was there in the middle of this big, huge cathedral, looking around with nobody in it. Everything had disappeared. And I was like, so this is Papa's heaven.
Okay.
Then I woke up. And when I woke up, I was back in the bed where the whole dream started. And it was like the first day that you open up the house after winter. Open up the house for the first time, the windows and all that stuff, and the spring air comes in and the freshness. That was the feeling after I woke up after that particular dream. And it stuck around for about 2 or 3 days. It was a fantastic feeling, but I never saw that Homer.
Was that the point that...
That was the end of it.
Okay.
I hadn't seen. Now, I've seen full-body apparitions. You know, I kind of... The last one I seen was in a living room, and I was in the kitchen. The first floor is set up to where the kitchen looks. You can look directly through the dining room into the living room.
Okay.
And I was at the corner of the kitchen making coffee or something. And I just so happened to look around, and there stood this guy that I'd never seen before in my life. Dressed in a, I guess, probably 50s, 30s kind of dress.
Okay.
Suspended pants and had an old long-sleeve shirt rolled up past his elbows.
Okay.
Kind of like he just come in after doing some work, and I looked up at him, and I looked back, and kind of one moment he's there, next moment he wasn't, kind of deal. And I was like, what the heck is that? And by that time, I had changed how I was praying, and I prayed, and I said, I didn't give you permission to be in here, and did a the rebuke and stuff like that, and hadn't seen it since. But since I started doing that kind of prayer stuff, this place has been pretty calm.
Right.
Other than last time my girlfriend was here, and she's, I don't know, there was I've got a video of her coming down the hallway, that the same camera that took the picture of the picture being pulled off the wall.
Right.
She was coming down the hallway, and this orb was chasing her down the hallway, and I just so happened to see it directly after that. She kind of freaked out after I showed her that.
Oh.
She said, oh my god, this place is haunted. I said, yeah, I'd say this place is haunted, but nothing's going to bother. But she would never go downstairs in the basement.
I was about to say downstairs. I don't know what there is about basements. Basement cellars, it's like if it's haunted, it's to the worst degree. What is it about basements?
This particular basement, the property that I'm on around here is full of springs and underground lakes and rivers and stuff. One of my things, my brother was, he was a spelunker, amateur spelunker, where he'd go chase things down in caves and stuff.
Right.
And I haven't seen this picture, which I hope to see, maybe, if he still got it. He told me about this cavern he went into that he had rappelled down into. And it was a big, huge underground lake.
And let me tell you, I'm telling you right now, he rappels down into places.
He did when he was able, but he was, he told me about that. I said, no way. I said, what'd you do? He said, I'd rappel down. And this was actually in the news. The place I think he rappelled down, the story he told me about, he rappelled down. It was actually in the local news and actually hit national news as one of those weird stories that kind of hits news nationally for this local area. And a few men got stuck down there because of the rain that hit the place last year. And I said, I remember that. I think my brother had rappelled down in there. And what happened was these men rappelled down into that cave system.
Okay.
And rain hit, and it flooded, and they got locked down in that cave system.
Oh.
But this whole place, the reason, go back to the basement for this particular place, the basement, this whole basement has a lot of water seepage problems. We've got two big, huge sump pumps down there just keep it dry.
Okay.
So that's my theory. One of my theories for paranormal activity is there's some sort of water source.
Yes.
Either underground or you're right next to whatever. Now, one of the things I was going to reference, there is an old, used to be old trading track, probably about 50 yards from front of my house.
Okay.
That there's a tunnel that goes through this mountain, or not a mountain, hill, I guess. Mountains for some people, but this is a hill. And this thing had a fresh spring that was in it, and it was always almost partially flooded, even when it was functioning.
Okay.
So I know there is a water source underneath the house.
Significant enough that, yeah.
So one of the things that I did specifically when I first started living here alone was put a camera, a closed circuit TV camera, downstairs. So if you know, just to keep an eyeball on if one of the pumps failed or whatever,
right,
to see if it's going to start flooding. Because I remember stories of before they really got this the basement under control that it would flood 2-3 feet of water under there during good heavy rains. But I put one down there just to, you know, instead of me having to open up the door and scoot down to looking around in the basement,
right,
put a camera down to look at where the sump pumps were.
Okay.
And I could see most of the basement. It's a rather large basement, but I've seen so much activity down there.
Really?
One of the first times that I've actually still have the video. I was alone one night, and it was during, I think, January, and it was like minus something outside. And downstairs usually hovers, you know, just a few degrees lower than what outside is, just because it's underground. And I got a ding on my phone. I just had the one camera in the house at the time. It was downstairs basement. And I was upstairs, and I was singing some sort of old song my grandmother used to sing to me. I can't remember what it was. But I was circling around the basement door, which is in the hallway next to the bedrooms on the first floor. And I got this ding on my phone to alert me that something was downstairs that it caught motion detection. So I got in my room, pulled out my phone, popped up the alert, mm-hmm. and there was these two orbs that was solid. It wasn't like a piece of fuzz or anything. And it kind of danced around each other and then disappeared into the floor.
And they set off the motion detector?
They said, I still have it. I'll send it to you after the program so you can do whatever. But I've seen so much stuff down there. There is one that I thought I showed my girlfriend of this ball of something in the left corner of the visual field of that camera kind of slowly move off in the distance. It was rather large. And I posted it a couple times, and I thought she had seen it. I posted it on my Twitter feed, and she got a hold of me one night and said, "I've never seen that." And I was like, and said, "Well, I thought I showed it to you." She said, "Oh, my God, we're going to have to do some stuff in that house to get that basement clear." And I said, "All right, whatever we need to do." But, this old house has a rather robust history just because it had so many people visiting the old grocery store.
Right, right. Exactly.
Yeah. I can't tell you what other, you know, that's just me. I've got old pictures of this place where the paved street right in front of the house was an old wagon road. And this is one, the house I live in is one of the older houses in the town that I live in.
Uh-huh.
So, I say this old place has a lot of history I have no clue about. No clue whatsoever.
Let me ask you, was it one of those grocers where the people, the owners live upstairs? You know how you would see shops where the shop was on the first floor and would live above?
Yeah, sort of, kind of, but the grocery store was a 2, maybe a 3-story establishment.
Oh, it's pretty big then.
Yeah, it was more like a feed store slash all-in-one kind of mini Walmart for the day back in 1800.
Let me ask you, just out of curiosity, because I know that a lot of these grocery, they become like a trading post, but they also become, you know, like the center of where everybody gets together at, you know, where everybody like...
Yeah, I would suspect that's what it was.
That's what I was thinking, you know, besides people coming, if this was the place where, you know, people would hang out and talk and neighbors and exchange and... It's like, or the central meeting area where, you know, there's, in other words, there's more than just the traffic of people going to buy supplies.
Oh, yeah, I'd say it was a meeting hump for sure. It used to be my next door neighbor that I converse with on a regular basis. He used to live upstairs after the day. We've talked about, I never told him anything about what's happening in the house, but I would suspect he would be... He'll be open to believing what I've told the stories I told you. But this old used to be an apartment kind of deal on the second floor, and it was converted into a storage unit for, I think, the property owner at the time rented it out to another grocer that was in the area, and it grew to the point where they used that particular building before it was tore down as a storage unit kind of deal for the grocery in the area. But I remember as a kid, it used to be the place where the bus would stop as a kid. And you know, people, you know, all the kids would get in the easeways there to get out of the rain during the inclement weather. During the day. But since we've owned the property, my family's owned the property, that building has not stood since then. It's always been like a parking lot, concrete parking lot.
And what happened? They demolished it and then...
Yeah, I think what had happened was after the... It got to the point where the property owner that before my grandparents owned it got to the point where they didn't want to put any money in it to keep it up to county specs or town specs.
Right.
And they just raised it down to the ground.
Yeah.
So, but yeah.
Yeah, but still, there's that ground, that land still holds that energy.
Oh, I'd say like it's. I found several things in this house that were from prior occupants.
Right.
Like before, when my grandparents owned the house, the attic, they actually had to, I think the previous owner actually sealed the attic off for whatever reason.
Mm-hmm.
And my dad actually had to cut a hole up into the attic, and they found an old chest of old stuff up there. And I remember pilfering through the thing. But I don't remember anything specific about it. But this whole place has got some old remnants from way back when before I got it.
I bet. I bet.
But
you know what? What's that saying? If the walls could talk.
I don't want to know.
You're like, yeah, ignorance is bliss. Thanks.
Yeah, ignorance. I'll know it soon enough, I guess. But
I get it.
Get back. I'll tell one more story.
Okay.
The one about the NDE from heaven.
Yes.
Back when the first days I started. Oh, just a second. Actually, I think I need to take this phone call.
Yes.
Like I told you.
Don't worry about that.
I will, if you want me to come back and tell the stories again.
I will be getting a hold of you. Do not worry, darling. I know we talked about this earlier. It's been wonderful. It's been great. You're wonderful. Great. I wish you the best of luck in everything. And I'll be talking to you.
Okay. All right. Well, just let me know. Hope your listeners have a great day. Please go to iamdarkwaters.com. That's where my repository of shows are. You can hear me on Paranormal Radio app under the Dark Waters Radio channel.
Yes.
Plus, we are now on uprntalkradio.com, 107.7 FM out of the Big Easy down in Louisiana.
I'll put a link in the credits of the show for you also as well, Sean.
Okay. Sounds great.
Take care.
Thank you. Have a great day, Marlene.
Likewise. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Wow. Yeah, we had discussed earlier that he might have to take a certain phone call. And, you know, so it was, as a matter of fact, I was like, and I'm glad that I was able to get a 2 hours worth of time of Sean telling stories. He's a great storyteller. And what I like about it is that he's got so many of his own personal experiences. Let me tell you something, that NDE, his own personal one, and that is like, you know, because I remember reading all those books by Dr. Moody, who did back in the 90s, the book about, you know, the interviews that he had. As a matter of fact, I want to say he was the one that coined that term of near-death experience. I'm not sure, but I believe he did. But anyway, he was the one, as a medical doctor, which he kind of put his neck out in the line, I imagine, because that went and started interviewing people that had come back, you know, resuscitated, whatever the case might be. And he was the one that, you know, you heard the thing about the white tunnel of white light and the seeing people, you know, your loved ones that have passed on, and that whole review and being told you got to go back or not your time. Yeah, and it was kind of like as a matter of fact, the premise of what he was saying was, here he was interviewing, because remember, this is prior to there being publications about the white tunnel, the tunnel of light or whatever, was how he was getting a very similar description from all these different people who had no connection to each other all describing the same thing, and that's when he compiled the book that he did. But anyway, the point being that after so many years of that publication, a lot of people, when you talk to them about near-death experience, they automatically think of that tunnel with light and like a certain, it's a formula, it's stereotypical. And then you hear his experience. And by the way, you know, I have heard, you know, of other people having like a really, very, really dark near-death experience. But those have always been the minority of them. And then you hear about what he had. So let me tell you something, that reptilian, I thought, I was like, what? That's, ugh. And that thing that splashed down with him, that would, God. Okay. But anyway, I mean, we could go with that in a lot of different directions. But again, when we go into, you know, when you talk about ghosts or survival of the human soul, spirit, whatever you want to call it, after the death of your body, okay, this is, I think, where you believe. Let's say if you're one of these people that's on the fence, you believe, or at the very least, you have to like say, okay, there's got to be a possibility about this. In other words, let's go with the typical Christian belief of heaven. You know, the one you always hear about was, you know, you go to the pearly gates or you go to hell, or, you know, based on the kind of life you had lived, was whether you were taken into heaven and that was it, you know, or you went to the hot place. It was that simple. Pearly gates, angels. And I know that the Christian belief, which is that the dead will rise the second coming of Christ. But prior to what Dr. Moody did, there was very rarely that description of the near-death experience of people coming back, which, by the way, is more common because now people are more easily resuscitated from trauma that before would have killed somebody. Like, there was no way that they were going to be able to bring you back. Now they have so many drugs, things to get your heart restarted. People now know more about CPR to keep, let's say, your heart beating until, you know, then you would say, okay, more people are having this experience. But then you start hearing about what he described, which is not the standard thing, but I want to say almost in a way more credible. You know, you do hear about, like, for example, because, you know, there's a people that say, well, you know what, those feelings that people that have NDEs, you can replicate it by stimulating certain parts of your brain. And they've even done it with people saying, oh, I feel a presence in the room, and it's because, you know, they've been, you know, stimulated certain parts of the brain. But there's been people that have been able to describe conversations and seeing things in other, I mean, because, you know, you have the thing where the person says, I was floating above my body, I looked down, I saw the procedures that were being done to me by the staff, by the doctors, I overheard their conversations, and people would say, well, you know what, maybe you were, you know, your hearing was there. In other words, you were still alive and they were working on you, trying to bring you back, but your hearing was there, and basically you're remembering. And your mind made up what it thought it looked like. But then you have the other ones that discount that, because there's people that say, you know, I floated above my body, I looked at the doctors working on me, and I was able to travel outside of that room, go to another room, sometimes even down the hallway where the family's at. And they can describe people what they were saying, hearing, like, okay, so how does that work? You know, you can't stimulate the brain to know about conversations or about events taking place where you're physically not at. Which later on they've checked out and they said, yeah, that did occur, but how do you know that? you're basically being resuscitated in another room. But then you think about, well, this thing of what he described, which is something that dovetails a lot, where these people that have these near-death experiences feel this non-judgmental kind of love, which is what he talked about as being in the presence of God. You know, in other words, there was no, even when, let's say, you're reviewing maybe whatever you did or didn't do during your lifetime, there is no judgment. Which, by the way, I think is significant, because that first part, which is, I think, was his first clue, which is why he kind of got upset, which is like he was getting grief about something he did as a kid. It's like, what? And it was like it's very judgy. And then the difference as to the other experience, where there was no judgment, there was no, you know, whatever. Yeah. Which I want to, you know, and a lot of people say, well, you know, because everybody thinks of, even in a lot of ancient cultures, the Egyptians, where they would say, you know, you, when you would go into the afterlife, your heart would be weighed. When they said your heart, basically they were saying, what kind of person had you been? Basically on that scale was whether you could proceed into the afterlife or not. And this was a very ancient culture which predated Judeo-Christian beliefs in heaven or hell. But I want to say that, I don't know, maybe I'm being very idealistic, but I do, that sounds to me like more what I would expect heaven to be, which is that non-judgmental overview, if you want to look at it, of what you've done. And by the same token, you think, okay, well, Marley, maybe you're looking at it as a person, because I haven't done anything, like, I'm not a psychopath or whatever. You know, is that the same experience? Somebody, let's say, that's a psychopath. When I say, I mean, a murderous psychopath, because you could be a psychopath and not kill people. But let's say somebody that's really, really, truly done horrible things, intentionally. Like I've said, people sometimes that have killed other human beings, I mean, horrible, and that sometimes never get caught. You know, they live out their lives, and maybe, if at all, their crimes, no, they are never prosecuted, they're never identified, and they live a long life. And you think, okay, well, what kind of experience does this person have when they die? If they even have any regrets while they're alive, do they create their own hell? What happens when they do this review of what their actions were and what became of it? What if you're one of these people that you didn't care while you were alive? You didn't even care when you're old, because, you know, there's sometimes you hear these people do these really horrific things when they're younger, and then as they age out, whether it's because of fear or whatever, but they kind of feel bad about what they did. But what if you're one of these that it was, I enjoyed it, I did it, and I'm an old fart, and I don't care if I had a chance to do it, I'd do it again. So what if you're that kind, that psychopathic, no remorse kind of person, and you die, and you're doing this review thing, and you're looking at all these scenes, and you're like, what happens to that person? Or the spirit of that person? I don't know. I don't know. I wonder, I mean, does that person go into what we call hell? If you think about, if you want to believe in some type of reincarnation theory, does this person come back into circumstances where they understand basically being at the receiving end of what they perpetrated? And, you know, and it's almost like something that they acknowledge on a soul level. So I'm thinking, you know, you always hear these theories of, if you, let's go with the theory of reincarnation, or basically that you pick and choose the circumstances of the life that you're going to live, from your parents to the setting, because there's something maybe that you need to learn, something you didn't catch. By this, I don't mean bad stuff, just stuff that you didn't catch around the first time, or you were like, and supposedly, let's say you're you're one of these souls that did really bad things. So they're like, okay, back, go back, get back in line. And I'm thinking to myself, how does a soul, because usually you think of you making a conscious choice to put yourself in these circumstances of another human being because so you could understand it. And I'm thinking to myself, what if you're not sorry about it? Because usually you always think there's some type of contrition involved in that choice of, okay, I'm going to go back and I'm going to live this life that will really teach me on a soul level what it was like maybe to be victimized or who knows, whatever. But you always think of there's some type of contrition involved in that choice. What if you're not, if you're one of these people that's not sorry? Or, let's go down there. What if you've got an attachment similar to what he described? Something like that. Oh God, that's scary. It says we're back together again or something like that. What if you had a dark attachment all along that's with you? Like, here we go again. Huh? Because, you know, there is that theory that attachments will follow you from lifetime to lifetime. What if your soul is trying to put itself in a lifetime under certain circumstances to help better itself, to basically understand what I did wrong or overcome this, whatever. But you have this attachment that's been with you, which is trying desperately to, like, keep you off. In other words, bettering your soul, coming to an understanding, making up maybe for the bad things you did. I mean, it's a real, I mean, how many times are you going to go back on that loop of here we go again, because you've got this attachment that wants to pull you off this track of either, whether you want to call it redemption, enlightenment, whatever. Because, yeah, by the way, when it comes to attachments, a lot of people think, and I've spoken of this before, of where they can piggyback on a soul, and you can even have a piggyback on a piggyback. And a lot of people think that once the person dies, it's had an attachment, you know, that attachment is, that's it, the bond is broken. And no, a lot of times the attachment will continue on with that soul, especially, not all the time, even if it's including, it's if it's a non-human attachment, it will, you know, not, in other words, death of the physical body does not sever the attachment. Remember, this attachment is on a metaphysical plane. So even though that human body that was once occupied by that original human spirit dies, the connection is still there with whatever's been with them, like a parasite. Like a parasite. So, I mean, this, it's pretty horrific, pretty scary, but I have heard and had my own personal experiences when I was doing hypnotherapy that leads me to believe that as scary or as not wanting to believe that something like this could exist, I've seen and read a lot of instances where there has to be something to that. There really truly has to be something to that. And I'm glad he pointed out something which I've talked about, that he says after I started doing certain prayers a certain way, everything's calmed down. In other words, because it sounds almost like he had like an open door policy where all these discarnates were coming through to him. And I think on a soul level, he's saying, this is not for me. Like, and I'm glad he pointed out, like, when I do these prayers, I've been doing it a certain way, that's it. Like, if you're thinking you're not welcome, it's like, get out of here. Don't even come. And I've talked about this where a lot of people that have had some type of haunting, and even if they've had, whether it was clergy or a paranormal group, clear the house and everything, it's like, you got to keep this going. Even if it's cleared, you still got to keep this going, because for some reason, there might be something on the property that's either a portal, it might bring in other entities. There might be somebody in the family or in the household that is a medium and is going to be bringing in discarnates who want to communicate. It could be a series of things where you do need to keep up a system of protection, of prayer, of blessing your place, your property. It's, in other words, and people are saying, well, what do you mean? When do I stop doing this? The truth is, you might have to say never. Never. And by this, I don't mean every day you walk around. It might be something you do once a month, depending on what level of activity is going on in your house. But for lack of a better word, it's almost like when you spray down your lawn, or you do it, you know, that you say, I do this, you know, because I want precaution. I know I got to keep doing this, or if not, these pests are going to come back. So you do it on a regular basis, and that's it. It's a maintenance thing. Well, this is along the same lines. There's a lot of factors that can affect that. And I want to say, because there's a lot of people that say, well, I say my prayers. That's good. But I think in a situation like this, again, because of, there's certain prayers that you need to say that specifically addresses, what you want to call it, rebuking, or saying, I'm not allowing anything negative, only light and love, whatever. In other words, it specifically addresses keeping out unwanted discarnates, good or bad. And by this, I mean, you know, because everybody thinks of the, you know, it could be something with an evil intention, not human. It could also be somebody that's deceased that was a good person, but they've just lost their way. And you need to keep them out and let the other side find a way to bring them into the light. Okay? You know, believe sometimes these spirits, these discarnates, are blind because they either they don't understand or they don't want to accept the fact that they passed away. For a variety of reasons. Medication. Suddenness. Or you'll get it where some people think it's not fair. I wasn't supposed to die. It's not fair. Like they don't want to accept that they're no longer living. And you think, man, how? And those entities, you need to, don't worry. But at some point, you know, you could pray for them, peace be with you. But at some point, don't worry. Either angels or their loved ones or somebody's going to come for them as long, and once they're ready, like that free choice thing, to go on into the light. But in other words, but you need to put up like a certain type of prayer that's specific to keeping your area, your house, your property, your person clear, and like a defense up, which is, if you're wandering and you're thinking this is a pit stop, think again. Yeah. I can understand what I'm glad he made that distinction. But anyway, guys, I hope you like the show. I'm definitely going to bring Shawn back. He's a great storyteller. He has fantastic stories. We talked so much before we started recording. I was like, I need to record this, but it was so fascinating. I could be there like, oh, I absolutely can see why his girlfriend and his family and everything are like, tell us more, talk to us some more about the ghost stories. Guys, I hope you like it. A lot of interesting guests coming on. And again, thank you for spending this time with me. You are all wonderful. Take care.